Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 13th meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in Session 6. And before we begin, can I ask those committee members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Our first item of business this morning is an evidence session looking at the impact of the climate and nature emergencies on our remit. Today we will focus on two areas. Firstly, we'll be focusing on innovation and new approaches to the environmental challenges within the marine environment. And I welcome to the meeting our first panel, who will be discussing the marine environment, and that's Dr. Alistair Rennie, a project manager from Dynamic Coast, Rachel Shuchman-Smith, marine spatial planning manager from the University of the Highlands and Islands, Shetland, Dr. Fiona Reid, Scottish Entanglement Alliance, and Danny Renton, the Chief Executive Officer from Sea Wilding. As you'll be aware, we had to cancel this session last week due to technical problems, so I very much appreciate the witnesses making themselves available to give their time again today. I'm going to invite Dr. Rennie to make a brief opening statement setting out the background about his innovation project, followed by Rachel, Dr. Eden Foley, and finally Danny Renton. Thank you. Good morning, Dr. Rennie.
Good morning, convener. Can I check you can hear me okay?
Yes.
Great. Thanks very much for the opportunity to provide evidence to the committee this morning. Over the last few weeks, the world's eyes have been on Glasgow, and for the next hour or so, our minds will turn to Scotland's coast and marine environment. During this session, I hope you'll appreciate the strong links between the global efforts at COP and the work that the public sector and some private partners are now doing on Scotland's coast. Whilst COP26 had four high-level goals of mitigation, adaptation, finance and collaboration, our research underlines the importance of this approach domestically. My role is to improve and explain the evidence base on coastal change, which aims to support better decision-making. This will help Scotland become sea level wise and climate resilient. If you haven't already, please do visit dynamiccoast.com. I hope through our discussions, the following aspects will be explored. Climate change is already affecting Scotland's coast, and under all future climate scenarios, coastal erosion and associated flooding will increase in rate and extent. Dynamic Coast is part of the Scottish Government's approach to building climate resilience and supporting adaptation. This is an area where we must appreciate our inheritance. £15 billion worth of coastal assets are being protected by nature. And as a society, we must incrementally improve this year on year to ensure future generations are better prepared. Nature and the climate emergencies, as you know, are one and the same. We need to help nature to help us. This is a joint effort. The Scottish Climate Change Adaptation Programme confirms that coastal erosion is a cross-cutting threat affecting multiple sectors of society. But we can and we must act to become sea level wise. Our shared challenge is to understand how the risks will increasingly affect us, our assets, our communities, our nature, and our natural and artificial coastal defences, and how we can flexibly respond to safeguard society. Dynamic Coast provides the evidence base on coastal change across Scotland. The final model run included 5.5 million calculations at 10-metre intervals for every decade to 2100. On high, medium, and low emission scenarios for our open, erodible coast. We have mapped the change against society's assets to inform the National Coastal Erosion Risk Assessment. This sits alongside assessments of coastal erosion enhanced flooding, detailed supersite analysis showing resilience and adaptation options at 6 locations, vegetation edge analysis, coastal erosion disadvantage, which explores the social vulnerability to erosion, and entirely new novel coastal monitoring techniques using satellite data. Whilst the challenge posed by climate change is stark, we are improving our ability to monitor, learn, innovate, plan, and adapt together. I look forward to these discussions and to your questions.
Thank you very much. And can I now move on to Rachel Shuchman-Smith?
Thank you, convener. Can you hear me?
Yes, that's fine.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to give evidence. My name's Rachel Shuchman-Smith. I'm the Marine Spatial Planning Manager at Shetland UHI. And my role here is to coordinate the Scotland's first marine plan under the Marine Act for a marine region. So as one of the first areas, it's provided us the opportunity to develop a number of work streams and test approaches which can inform marine planning going forward across Scotland. And as part of that, in terms of carbon, we provide an opportunity for increased representation by communities, and that's particularly important as we transition to a low carbon future. So representational justice for our fisheries, fishing communities, recreational users is particularly important in areas like Shetland or Orkney or the Western Isles, where marine renewables are likely to be particularly important as we seek to decarbonise. And one of these, the important things of providing this opportunity to participate is the provision of data. And one of the things we've tried very hard in Shetland to do is ensure that decisions are based on the best data available. And that has a benefit to communities because they're represented in decision making. It prevents impact on existing uses such as fisheries, which could be avoided. But it also provides an opportunity for the developers to site developments in the best location to avoid objections later on in the consenting process. So avoiding delays helps the developers avoid costs. The other important thing that marine planning can provide to communities, but then also for from a carbon perspective, is ensuring that any knowledge of blue carbon sinks, such as horse mussel beds or mull beds, are correctly identified. And marine users often have quite good knowledge of where these habitats may or may not occur. And in Shetland, we've worked very closely with our inshore fisheries community to map these particular habitats, which are blue carbon sinks, and then for them to lead the adoption of protective measures to ensure they're not damaged. And marine carbon sinks are of greater actual importance than our on-land equivalents. They sequester greater quantities of carbon. And by working with the local fishermen here, we've identified very large areas of protected habitats that were previously unknown. And because it's been led by the local community or done in partnership with the local community, they're also far more receptive with any protective measures that have since been put in place. So across Shetland, we now have a series of 25 closed areas to fisheries, which the fishermen led and has protected important blue carbon sinks. So as marine planning's rolled out across Scotland, there's an opportunity to really embed this agenda within marine planning at a local level, which will help Scotland deliver these national objectives that we have, but a more local level and working with communities to achieve them.
Thank you very much, Rachel. And now, Dr. Fiona Reid.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity to provide evidence on marine animal entanglements in Scotland. So the Scottish Entanglement Alliance, which we refer to as the Sea Project, was initiated by fishers. So fishers approached WDC about entanglements in their gear, like the krill fishers. And during a meeting with Marine Scotland, Whale and Dolphin Conservation raised the issue of entanglement and were advised to apply for the European Marine Fishing Funding. So we applied for EMF funding and the Sea Project started. It was a collaboration between the krill fishing industry and another five organisations, including Nature Scot, Hebridean Whale and Dolphin Trust, British Divers Marine Life Rescue, and the Scottish Marine Animal Stranding Scheme. So during the project, 159 fishers were interviewed about their experience of entanglement, and this was representative of 11% of the krill fleet in Scotland. Based on the interviews, we found that entanglements occurred all around the Scottish coast. And although the number reported is low, when we extrapolated the results from SMASH BDLMR and the interviews, we found that only 5% of the entanglements have been reported to the different networks. More species were reported entangled than we had anticipated or knew about, including basking sharks and small cetaceans, such as the harbour porpoise. Entanglements are a severe welfare issue. Entangled animals suffer or die for many weeks or months carrying the heavy gear, which compensates their health by their feeding and diving ability and causing severe injuries caused by the abrasions of the rope to the animals. For individual fishers, the occurrence of an entanglement is very rare. For most of them, it was once in the lifetime experience, or they experience one around every 10 years. However, the extent and incidence of entanglement events in Scottish waters may be sufficient to impact at a local population level for some species, such as the minke whale and the humpback whale. And there may also be population level impacts on other species with high bycatch rates in different gears, such as harbour porpoise and common dolphin. So the co-occurrence of krill effort and minke whale sightings were mapped to identify potential high-risk areas for entanglement, and these were identified as the east of the Outer Hebrides, the west of North Uist, and throughout waters around Skye. And photo identification records of minke whales on the west coast of Scotland from a long-term project by the Hebridean Whale and Dolphin Trust, where they assessed the evidence of entanglement, found that over 22% of the animals that they encountered had entanglement-related scars. During this project, we also were able to collaborate with the International Whaling Commission for their Global Whale Entanglement Response Network. And we did Europe's first disentanglement training workshop for the fishermen, which was very successful. And the project overall demonstrated a positive collaboration between the fishing industry, research and conservation organisations. And solutions to entanglement are available. We know that certain species are caught in certain areas of the gear, such as basking sharks and minke whales are caught in the ground line of the krill gear, whereas humpback whales and other cetaceans and turtles are caught more in the end line of the gear, which is the line that takes the gear up to the surface. So there are solutions for the mitigating against the entanglement in the end line. There's the possibility of the rope lift, very weighted rope, and there's also the rope lift gear, which is often called the on-call gear. And we look forward to discussing this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fiona. And now, finally, not least, Danny Renton.
Convener, thank you very much for inviting us to join the committee. I represent an organisation called Sea Wilding, a community-led charity, and we're based up at Craignish in Argyll. And the purpose of the charity is to try and restore biodiversity to the loch. Our loch is about 80 kilometres in circumference. It's very typical of other Scottish sea lochs. We know from Victorian accounts that biodiversity has changed. It used to be full of fish, full of natural wonders. It no longer is. The drivers of change are the likes of aquaculture and all the environmental problems associated with that. And the other one is the fact that scallop dredges are still allowed to come right into the loch and dredge right up to the shoreline and destroy the ecosystems. So as a charity, we wanted to get together and look at how we, rather than just wringing our hands, what we could do to try and reverse some of this. And we started looking at some of the things that disappeared from the loch, and they were native oysters. We have a relic population of around 200 left. They used to be here in abundance, and also seagrass. And just to talk a little bit about native oysters and seagrass, around the UK coastline, over 90% of both these priority marine features have disappeared. They're absolutely critical ecosystem builders, the keystone species for habitat, and here in Loch Craignish, what we want to do is and to research different methodologies for doing this at low cost, that we could help other communities do the same. We got a grant from the National Lottery to put down $1 million over a five-year period. We've put down nearly 300,000 so far, and also a grant from Nature Scotland, we're very grateful for that, to plant a quarter of a hectare of seagrass, which we're doing at the moment, and that grant comes to an end in March next year. Forgive me, my phone keeps ringing. I'm trying to turn this off. The purpose of this is really to make it very community orientated. We have six schools involved. We have five different universities involved looking at carbon sequestration and also environmental DNA and biodiversity change over time. And the idea is to develop these low-cost best practice methodologies that we can roll them around the Scottish coastline to other communities. And we think there's a real hunger for this. There's a sense amongst many coastal communities that they've been slightly dispossessed from the fisheries debate. They were not included in the inshore fisheries groups. We've seen chronic biodiversity loss in all these Scottish sea lochs. We continue to see scallop dredging and bottom trawling right up to the shoreline. And the result of this is a collapse in biodiversity and a collapse of economic opportunity. We genuinely believe if we can work together to restore biodiversity, then there is real economic opportunity for many in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you all for your introductions. We have members' questions now, which will take us up to round about 10:30. And I would like to kick off. We've heard about some individual projects which are very area-based and some wider research that's been done. But is current policy supportive of innovation and mainstreaming your research findings? Or what policy structural changes need to change to support new and ongoing projects which will achieve some of the outcomes that we need to reverse the biodiversity loss? And I'm just going to start and go around everybody for this question. So can I start with Dr. Rennie, please?
Thank you, Convener. So I think at the moment the supporting policy structures that we have as far as innovation are very reasonable. The Dynamic Coast project itself is a fine example of an idea that started off with a PhD project supported by Nature Scott, as it happens, looking into the assets that are behind our erodible shore. From that, through discussions within Nature Scott and within partners across government and government itself, the project was born. That has spurred other innovations, both on a pure research, but also in broader sort of policy areas and further discussions. So I'm very comfortable with the achievements that we have made and the, if you want, the policy ecosystem that supports that. I do think, however, the challenge is rising and we will need to continue to redouble our efforts in this area to make sure that we are up to the challenge in the future.
Thank you. And Rachel?
Sorry. If I think of some of the achievements we have, for instance, creating the closed areas for fisheries, that was only possible because the first act of the Scottish Parliament was to give Shetland control out to its 6-mile limit. And that's not been replicated to any other community in Scotland. So some of the innovation we've been able to achieve in Shetland isn't possible for any other community to achieve at the moment. The other part of that is obviously policy and legislation and regulations are three things that underpin any statutory bringing about of management. And some of the challenges such as biosecurity, invasive species invasions, at a local level, we're lacking regulation that create clear laws that we can enforce as a marine area. We have the Wayne Act, which is a very good piece of legislation that makes it illegal to spread non-native species, but we don't define that in the way that we do for some other things like contamination of the seabed, which has very specific things like 5 milligrams of copper or whether it might be. But we don't stipulate things like boats must not move if they are, it is illegal, or you must clean your boat X number of times a year. So some challenges facing the marine environment aren't clearly regulated for, so it makes it very difficult to enforce at a local level. So whilst Scotland does have a very good series of policies, it isn't always underpinned by specific enough regulation to allow that to be implemented.
Thank you. Just before we move on, I know Beatrice has got some specific questions about what you're doing in Shetland, but you've got a successful marine planning area. Now, that might be because it's a very compact area, relatively. Do you think there should be legislation about, you know, ensuring that all stakeholders around the table, you know, we heard that some coastal communities weren't involved in inshore fisheries, whatever. Is that something that we should see more of? And would that help put policies in place where everybody came together in arguments over scallop dredging or creel static gear, where it's very polarised at the moment? Would it help with that?
I would see, so I mean, Shetland Marine Planning Partnerships provide, we have the ability to do that via direction from Scottish Government, and that will hopefully at some point be rolled out across Scotland, but that process hasn't taken place yet. And it does provide the opportunity to bring everyone together. The Scottish Government does also have the IFGs to enable them to do that, but they don't have power making ability. Our Marine Planning Partnership does, and will, all the other marine regions will have plan making ability, but the IFGs for fisheries, they isn't. The IFCAs in England have plan making ability, but they don't in Scotland. So without that statutory underpinning, it's difficult to elicit change in our fisheries practice at a local level, even if it's desired by the local communities.
Thank you, that's helpful. And I've got a supplementary from Ariane.
Yeah, this is a supplementary to everybody. Following on convener's kind of initial question around policy, I'd like to hear whether you feel there's enough support in the current policy environment to ensure a timely and just transition for coastal sectors and communities to ensure that they can continue utilising our marine and coastal habitats as new measures are brought in to reduce the impact on biodiversity. So it's that specific bit around what do we need in terms of support to ensure that just transition. So maybe I'll just start with Danny Renton and go round.
Our view fundamentally is that, you know, we're not blaming the fishermen for the destruction of the seabed. It's a regulatory failure. They're permitted to do it. And you know, we want a just transition. We want financial support for fishermen who may be prevented from dredging in the inshore in the future. So, the policy isn't there at the moment. I mean, just to give a snapshot of where we are here in Loch Regnish, we have priority marine features in Loch Regnish. We have native oysters, we have seagrass, we have northern sea fans, we have the remnants of a merle bed, but it's been dredged. These are all supposed to be protected by law. None of them are. The loch, as I mentioned before, it still has dredges coming up with it as close as they can to the shoreline. And this is to the destruction of the ecosystem. And this is the same all the way up the west coast of Scotland. It has been since 1984. Simultaneously, we've seen the collapse of fisheries. White fish stocks are now commercially extinct. All we're fishing for now is the bottom of the food chain. It's lobsters, crabs, scallops and prawns. There's nothing left. And if you want to restore biodiversity, you have to respect that the fish spawning grounds and the nurseries are in inshore waters. They used to be, they're no longer. Divers tell me that, you know, back in the 70s, you could dive along the west coast of Scotland and it looked like the Red Sea, not as colourful, but certainly as diverse. Now, in many of these places, it just looks like a desert. And we need to address that. If we don't address that, then it's meaningless trying to restore biodiversity at the scale that we are, because we're just doing it right at the fringes. We're not addressing the problem.
Thank you for that, Danny. And I'd just like to add another little bit, so if you can come back on this. So National Planning Framework 4 has a policy section on coasts. So if you could just put that into your response too. I'd like to hear if you've actually read it and what you think about it.
Sorry, are you talking to me?
Yeah, so yeah. I'm talking to everybody, but I didn't get that to you as well. So have you managed to have a look at the National Planning Framework 4? It's okay if you haven't. A lot of people haven't.
No, I haven't. But can I just make one further point just about policy? Is that you know, currently the Scottish Government says 37% of Scottish waters are marine protected areas. I mean, that's a myth, really, isn't it? Because actually only 5% of that is protected from bottom trawling and dredging. And we know that 5% is not really protected either. And I'll give you a version, and I'll give you an example of this. Only the other day, I was standing at the Craignish Peninsula overlooking one of the few MPAs that is protected against bottom trawling. And that's because we have the flapper skate that exists there. It's a nursery ground for that. And I'm standing there, it's dark. I'm looking at a dredger that's just come into the MPA. Because dredgers are still not required to turn on their vessel monitoring systems, that's been promised by the government since 2017 and has still not happened. And only 100 dredgers, but the 100 dredgers in Scotland, only 14 are actually required to turn on their automatic identification systems. I watched the dredger come in. It does have its AIS on because I'm following it on the Marine Scotland Marine Tracker. It gets into the MPA, then turns off its AIS and turns off its lights right in the middle of the MPA, just as it's getting dark. Now, I'm afraid that's happening everywhere. We all know that's happening. And Marine Scotland is powerless to stop it. So whilst the policies might be there, some of the policies are there, they're just not implemented.
Thank you for that. Hear from the rest of the panel around the specifics of the just transition.
Ariane, just before we move on, I think there's that Rachel had a supplementary on that she just wanted to ask on that topic.
Yeah, can I just clarify, Mr. Renton, do you believe that Marine Scotland are not doing enough to stop illegal trawling?
Yeah, I mean, every single coastal community that watches this believes that Marine Scotland is not doing enough. And it's not that Marine Scotland doesn't necessarily want to do it. It means that they don't have the resources to do it. So, for example, if I were to ring up Marine Scotland and see a dredger in the MPA where it's not supposed to be and believe that it's acting suspiciously at night, which is what happens, but normally they turn their lights off, Marine Scotland would tell me they don't work at night. And secondly, they'll log the call, but the dredgers that have been caught, there's just one fixed penalty, which is £2,000. And that's absolutely meaningless when you go into an area that's protected and start dredging it for scallops. Your catch is worth infinitely more than that. So it's really, Marine Scotland doesn't have the resources and currently isn't fit for purpose to do what it needs to be doing.
Just on the back of that, you're making some very broad statements there that you would appear that this law-breaking is widespread. I would challenge that. That's not what we've heard in previous sessions. And also, you suggested that much of the seabed is destroyed. You're not quantifying it, and it's a very broad statement. Again, we heard from marine scientists from Aberdeen University and suggested that wasn't necessarily the case. There were some isolated incidents of damage to the seabed, but it wasn't much of the seabed. Can you comment on what you mean by much of the seabed?
Well, all the evidence is there, is in, Scottish Marine assessments, things about the amount of seabed that's been destroyed. And this has been, this is sort of, so, for example, I mean, in our loch here, there is only 2 months ago, we discovered evidence of a scallop dredger inside the loch within metres of the shore. This is on a reef that is usually dived by scallop divers. And then we discovered that relatively recently, a scallop dredger has been up there and destroyed that shelf. A few months ago, I was in the Loch Fyne Marine Protected Area, just off Minard, and there's a prawn trawler within metres of the shore there, right up inside the MPA. 3 weeks ago, off Gairloch, there were reports of an illegal scallop dredger there. That was reported to Marine Scotland. In the Marine Protected Area here, off Easdale, last summer, divers went down and found fresh dredging evidence in an area that's not only banned for scallop dredgers, but is also a site of an area of conservation. So, I mean, to say it's not happening, we don't know. We have evidence that it's happening, but to take it from the industry that it's not happening on Marine Scotland is they don't know. You need to speak to local communities, and more than anything, you need to speak to local divers who will tell you how the seabed has been destroyed. It's been fundamentally destroyed all up the west coast of Scotland. And I think the science suggests that's why we don't have white fish anymore on the west coast of Scotland. And you certainly don't have it in the Clyde, where all you're fishing for now is prawns and lobsters. I mean, you'll be aware of the the Lam Lash no-take zone, which is just 2 kilometres, 2 square kilometres, and that's only been around for a few years, set up by the coast community there, the coast group. And the uptick in biodiversity there is absolutely phenomenal. And against the backdrop of the Clyde, where the fisheries is absolutely dead. And this was one of the richest fisheries in Northern Europe only 100 years ago. So I don't think we can underestimate what the lifting of the inshore limits has done to fisheries and to the cost of economic opportunity for many.
Thank you. And Ariane's got some questions on just transition, I think we're going to go back to.
Just wanted to come back to the rest of the panel to just see, pick up on the question around, is the current policy environment, is there enough support in the current policy environment to ensure a timely and just transition for coastal sectors and communities? So if anyone else wants to come in on that, I'd really appreciate it. And also just chime in if you have read the coast section of the MPF4, you don't have to have.
Sorry, thank you. So the two questions as far as the just transition, we've made a start in from a little higher up the water than what Danny was referring to earlier on. From a coastal perspective, we have looked at the amount of erosion that's happening and also taken into consideration the social vulnerability of our communities. And we've used the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation and some of the census data to support that. And that's the first time that's been done, and it tries to get in to understand better the coastal erosion disadvantage, which is similar to the flooding disadvantage that the Scottish Government looked at earlier on. So that's the first time that's been done from a coastal perspective in Scotland, and it provides an opportunity for local authorities and other organisations to better understand the resilience, the social resilience of their communities, the social vulnerability of their communities, and their exposure to coastal erosion now and in the future. So whilst we may not have a direct perfect relationship there as far as that being deployed, because the science is still new, that's a tool that can be used by partners, and I hope will be used. To your second question of the NPF4, I have read it, and I think it has, well done. It marks an improvement in NPF3, and it builds upon earlier iterations. I think there are some further improvements that could still be made. As I understand it, we're in a consultation phase at the moment, and I'm sure those comments will be coming in from various different partners. So I see it as a step in the right direction with some further opportunities.
Thank you. And would anyone else like to come in on the just transition aspect in your area?
I wondered if I could make a comment. I think there's two parts to a just transition. At the moment, we're very focused on ensuring that the just transition enables, for instance, the electrification of vessels. But for communities, a just transition is also, somewhere like Shetland, we have a lot of offshore wind planned, we have tidal potential, and this is true of other communities like Orkney. And the just transition doesn't tend to focus on where the impacts of housing this technology is going to occur. In my mind, it's quite an urban perception of just transition. It's how we're all going to recycle more, use less, electrify our homes, etc. But it's ignoring distributive justice, which is thinking about where these impacts of transitioning are occurring, rather than the actual whether or not we can afford to implement the measures. And for rural communities, I think it's an important part of the transition process, because rural communities are predominantly housing these very big technologies, and obviously will have the potential to receive quite big benefits from that in terms of employment, but also all of the negative impacts, visual impacts, loss of access on land or on the sea are felt in these communities too. So when we're thinking about just transition, I think it would be an opportunity for the Scottish Government to think further about this, justice means for those communities. And also, a lot of the jobs being created at the moment are predominantly for white men. There's very little diversity in the jobs that are being created. So they are very good employers for our rural communities, but they're not employing a diverse range of people on gender or race. And if we're talking about renewables and justice surely has to talk to some of these other elements that make up a just society. So who these impacts are being received by and who the beneficiaries are, and helping to ensure that that's spread across all elements of society.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to move to Beatrice for some questions.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. Fiona, I wonder if I could ask you a bit more about entanglements in creels. You indicated in your opening statement that only 5% were actually reported, and I wonder if I could understand a bit more about the numbers of fishermen that were involved in that in the project to get an understanding of the figures between those that are reporting and who was reporting.
So we interviewed 159 fishers across the krill industry in Scotland, and that represents just over 11% of the industry in Scotland. And of those fishers, we had 146 entanglements reported, and for the majority of fishers, they'd only experienced one entanglement. A few fishers had two entanglements, and we had one fisher that had nine, and he had nine basking sharks in a short period of time, and he actually felt that maybe he hadn't cleaned his gear enough in between entanglements, and the animals had been attracted. That was the only fisher that had like a large number. And he said that he had released them all. So for the majority, it's like a very small number of fishers, but over half the fishers had experienced an entanglement. But the solution for entanglements or getting higher numbers, I think, isn't like as you would for other bycatch incidences, is to put observers on board, because it wouldn't be financially feasible. So we've been trying to raise the profile of the reporting schemes to fishers, and that there is help for them, because the majority of them had to release the animals themselves, which is also quite dangerous. So we've been trying to tell them that there is support, and if the animals are dead, could they please report them to the Scottish Marine Animal Stranding Scheme? And if the animals are alive, we've provided the fishers with like brochures for the wheelhouse and that, so that they've got numbers so that they can call for assistance and things. So the actual reporting's been low because I think fishers didn't know who to report it to, or that when they've got the animal in the gear, their immediate reaction is to just try to release the animal for the welfare of the animal, or if the animal's already died, I think. So that's why reporting's been low.
That's helpful. I think your point is well made about the safety of fishermen as well, and I think that's across the board. I wonder if you could also tell me what happens now with the project, because you said it's not clear where the funding will come from following the exit from the EU.
No, so the fund, it was actually a 2-year project funded by EMMF. So the project finished in March 2020, but the final report's not out because of delays due to COVID, but it should be out next week or the week after. So there currently isn't any funding for the project. We had applied for funding from NERC, but it wasn't successful. One of my colleagues who was the project manager of this, Ellie McClellan, is carrying on part of the work, well, small aspects of the work. So she's looking at entanglements for her PhD, but the actual SEER project, the funding's finished.
My final question is about the sort of impact on the fishing fleet of marine animal entanglements, not just inshore, but there's also a problem with gill netters. I wonder if you have anything to say on that.
So actually, for the bycatch of cetaceans in gill necks in Scotland, there's not very much data because there's not so many observers. The majority of the work's concentrated off the southwest of England so far. We're actually starting a project, hopefully at the moment, to speak to fishers, gillnet fishers, about bycatch. But that's aside from the sea project. sorry, what was the first part of the question?
Well, just the impact on the industry itself of the entanglement.
So I know the individual fishers, we asked them also about the economics of the entanglement, and nearly all of them said that they're not worried about the economic impact because they lose gears normally to bad weather and also to the mobile sector quite frequently. And their main concern was for the welfare of the animal. I think the problem is if there are entanglements and it is associated to krill gear, there's quite a lot of focus in the media, social media, and I think the industry gets a bad name, but we really try to say, like, this isn't, that it's not the fisher's fault, like they don't want to catch the animals. So we have just been trying to still create a positive profile for the krill fishers because they really worked with us for this project. They initiated the project. So, so hopefully that comes through.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I read a report from back in 2016 which suggested the entanglement of humpback whales in inshore Scottish waters were of a proportion which would potentially act as it would mean that the species was unsustainable, and that Scottish inshore waters could potentially act as a high mortality sink for the species in the whole of the Northeast Atlantic. Now, given we are in 2021 and there has been a substantial increase in fixed line and creels and whatever, which have been generally unregulated, do we need to act now to regulate the industry and push forward with policies which are going to help creel fishermen ensure that entanglements are far less frequent than they are just now, particularly given, you know, the underreporting that you've suggested?
And that, so we asked fishers about measures that they think we could, like, try for reducing marine animal entanglements, and that was one that a lot of fishers reported, that there needs to be regulation of the industry. And that there also needs to be some solutions for the conflicts with the mobile gear.
Thank you.
We're actually at the moment updating that paper.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on to questions for Mercedes and Rachel and then Jim.
Hi, morning, Fiona. Hopefully you can hear me okay. I've got two questions. So the first one is, just speaking about solutions to marine animal entanglement and thinking about sustainability of current fishing practices, I wondered if the Scottish Entanglement Alliance has a view on the relative sustainability of creeling over trawling in the same area of inshore waters.
So creeling is seen as, like, what they call a life gear, which is like a low impact, fuel efficient gear. And one of the things that the krill fishers did say is that the mobile sector often tow their gear and then their gear is dumped and they don't know where their gear is dumped, so they can't retrieve it. And I think having the fishers having, like, they know where their gear is and they know how many krills they're fishing with. And then if they then lose a lot of gear, also to bad weather or the mobile sector, there's an indefinite number of krills in the water and gear in the water. And without solutions like that, even if the industry is regulated, there's still going to be, like, a huge amount of gear in the water that we've got no idea where it is, how many there is, or mitigating that. One thing that Krillfish has also said was that they don't have anywhere to actually dispose of their gear. So that's another thing that needs to be improved in harbours or around the coast.
Thanks very much, Fiona. And then just one more follow-up in terms of reporting of the entanglements. Do you think monitoring and recording could be delivered through the use of remote electronic monitoring on the larger boats, on trawlers?
So, do I think electronic monitoring will...
So, would that be useful in terms of improving reporting and monitoring of incidents if larger boats were fitted with electronic monitoring?
Probably, but during this project, we didn't actually speak to any of the trawlfishers. We only spoke to the krillfishers, so we suspect that they might have issues like with bycatch, but we're not sure because we didn't actually speak to any of them. So originally we had planned to speak to them, but then as the project developed, we just focused on the krill industry and their entanglements, just to try to get an overview of like the situation in Scotland, because for some of the species, they'd never been reported entanglements in strandings or as live entanglements. So we actually got such a wider range of species than we initially thought, and all around the coastline, whereas we thought that there would be hotspots, we didn't expect the entanglements to be so widespread.
Thank you. Rachel will come in with a follow-up and then Jim.
Thank you. Dr. Reid, you're getting a lot of questions from us. It's a very interesting subject. Actually, can I just be clear about how your organisation believes that you can actually improve the monitoring of the bycatch? Because it sounds as if you need a whole lot more people feeding into this. But what is the actual process of gathering that data? I mean, is it something that you want to take forward with the work that you do? And do you need extra funding to be able to do that?
Yeah, so it's definitely going to need extra funds in, but I think recently there's now a legal obligation for fishers to report entanglements events. And so hopefully reporting is going to improve. And I think because the work has been conducted with the krill industry and it's been so positive working with them, hopefully if fishers do get an entanglement, they know who to contact. The solutions, there are solutions available. Like, we would really like to trial weighted rope on the ground line of the gear, and we would really like to trial the ropeless gear, which is like an on-call gear, in areas where we know there might be potential for hotspots for certain species. But again, at the moment, there's just no funding for it. So we've got the support of the fishers, so it's just the lack of funding that the work's not going forward at the moment.
Thank you. And finally on this topic, Jim.
Thanks, convener. And Fiona, you are getting another question from me, I'm afraid. I have to say, somebody who knows nothing about fishing, it sounds a wee bit like the Wild West out there. Can you tell me, you said that you were funded by the EU on a two-year project. How much was that funding, and who did you say that you'd apply to funding afterwards that was refused? I missed that last bit.
So the second part of funding we applied for was NERC funding.
Which is what?
The natural, I have to look it up. I think it's the Natural Environment Rural. No, what is it? I'll Google it in a minute.
We can come back to you. We'll write to you for some further information. We'll not put you in the spot now because I know what acronyms are like. They're very, very difficult.
Sorry. And then I'll have to also check how much this project received the funding, but it was the European Maritime Fisheries Fund that funded the work, and it was via Marine Scotland, and it was project managed by Nature Scott.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to sea wilding as a topic. Ariane, I'll kick it off. Oh, I beg your pardon. I'm sorry. Danny, would you like to come in? I forgot you indicated you'd like to come in on this topic before we move to Ariane.
Yes, very briefly. It was just about the entanglements and stuff. I spent quite a lot of time on the island of Tyree. In the last few years, around 200 tonnes of beach litter have been collected by volunteers, and about 80% of it is fishing gear, and a lot of it is creels. And they don't necessarily originate on Tyree. When creels get a certain buoyancy, when they get wrapped up in their lines and when they get towed by the mobile sector. So some of it may come from afar. One thing you notice is that none of them are marked, none of them are labelled. So even if it was a fleet of creels that got washed up in a storm that was locally owned, no one would necessarily know who to ring for them to come and salvage it and repurpose it if it was possible. So I think some form of marking and would be very helpful in the future, labelling.
Thank you for that. Ariane.
Thank you, Convener. So these questions are in general are going to be directed towards Danny, so you're on, and I think maybe colleagues will come in as well. So I'm very impressed with your projects and your aim to empower communities to manage their own inshore marine environments while addressing biodiversity loss, sequestering carbon and creating green jobs. Could you please say a little more about the benefits you have seen from community-led marine restoration and enhancement, including whether it has led to increased employment, community empowerment, cohesion, and possibly even repopulation?
Yeah, well, thank you for the question. In terms of our project, it's only been running now for a year and a half, so it's a bit too early to be able to say what sort of biodiversity change that we're going to see over time. But we're putting back 1 million native oysters. We put down around 300,000 so far. The survival rates on the seabed are around 40%, so currently it's looking really good. And we have a long-term hope that if we can restore the native oysters in abundance to the sea loch, we can set up a sustainable community oyster fishery. So in terms of green jobs, we have one full-time person employed. We have five people part-time employed, and that's to do with the seagrass. And we're planning to scale up. I mean, one of the things I was saying is that there is a real hunger for this around the Scottish shoreline. The Coastal Communities Network, for example, has 18 member groups. Many of them are interested in what we're doing. And next year, we're planning to roll out to Arran, to potentially to Knoydart, to the Friends of the Sound of Jura. We're helping the Edinburgh shoreline with their with some sort of degree of consultancy with their seagrass and oyster projects. So I think there are many green jobs in this in the future, and there are potential for sustainable fisheries if we can get biodiversity to return.
Thank you for that. On the scaling up or extending this type of project along the coastline, what support do you think would be needed from the Scottish Government, Marine Scotland or others?
Well there's a couple of things really. I mean firstly, you know, this sort of marine sort of habitat restoration is a very new thing. The science is very new. There isn't really the infrastructure to support us at the moment. In terms of the licensing, is problematic. You know, we have to apply for up to four licenses. It's very site specific as to what you're doing. Once you've established there's an ecological restoration opportunity and there's a community that can deliver it, because we want to do it at community level, we then have to go through the licensing process. When we started doing this 3 years ago, this was immensely complex. We were basically treated like a salmon farm. However, it is getting easier. Marine Scotland and Nature Scotland understand now what we're doing, and there are specific individuals we can now talk to and who are receptive to what we're doing. So it's becoming a more enabling environment. But if you're really scaling up, we're talking about funding. And funding is hard. I mean, we're a small charity. I spend all my time fundraising. We've been very fortunate in getting a national lottery grant, which enabled us to do the native voices at scale over a five-year period. Nature Scotland has been wonderful and has given us a large grant to do this proof of concept seagrass restoration project, which we're close to finalising. Part of that is a lot of science, and that's very important to show sort of carbon sequestration, environmental DNA to look at biodiversity change over time, all these sort of things. But these are decadal research projects. And one of the issues we have at the moment is our funding comes to an end in March next year. We've started all these different research projects, but the funding now comes to an end. So it's now incumbent upon us as a small charity to go out to all the respective sort of philanthropic donors and try and get more funding. We're confident we'll do that. But the SMEEF, the Scottish Marine Environmental Enhancement Fund, will not, we think, come into play, so we understand, and towards the latter half of next year. But it's too late for the second phase of our seagrass project. So we don't want to drop the ball now that we're running with it. But so funding is an important thing. So it's getting these sort of ducks in a line so we can actually roll these out at community level and at scale. And when I say at community level, I mean, it's not just that there's a hunger to restore biodiversity for all the economic reasons and all the sort of welfare reasons and wildlife reasons, but we also really think that there are green jobs in this. There's a real opportunity here for Scotland to restore what's been lost.
And Alistair Rennie wants to come in on the back of that.
Thank you very much. The question, I think, comes back to two aspects. One, we need to understand the need of where we can actually do more. And then we need to make sure the funding is actually allied to that to ensure that that then works more effectively and then trickles across and into different sectors. So I entirely agree with what Danny has just said. I would say, though, in the coming years, I think there will be more, and we're already doing that. The Scottish Government, as you may all be aware, announced a large funding package, multi-year package, £50 million for a nature restoration fund. Just last week, this year's allocation has been announced, £5 million has been announced, and within that, £80,000 will be going to the St Andrews Links Trust. The St Andrews Links Trust are the folk who run the world famous golf courses, but they also look after the dunes, and they've been doing Scotland's largest coastal nature-based solutions project there, repairing the sand dunes, making them more resilient, doing that whilst conserving nature. As we look forward for the challenge that comes down the track with climate change and the nature emergency, we'll need to be doing this for two reasons. We'll be needing to do it for resilience and making sure that we don't get impacted by events, but we also then need to be doing it as far as the biodiversity and for reasons of nature. So the funding is coming, or some of the funding is coming, and Danny's alluded to a few of those. More will have to come, and will, as the evidence improves and our ability to say we need to do something here, or we have a risk here, or we have an opportunity here, we then need to make sure that we're then able to go and enact that change and get in and do it based upon the best available evidence. So this is about multi-year and joined up and dynamic approaches. The solutions to today's problems will be slightly different from the solutions in 10 years' time and in 50 years' time. And we need a dynamic, adaptive approach to this, to make sure that we're getting the twin challenges best managed today with our communities for the local circumstances and the local nature, and looking forward and how that changes through time. Thank you.
Rachel has indicated she'd like to contribute.
Yes, thank you. In terms of the benefits that that can be brought to communities, when the Scottish Parliament allowed Shetland to have a regulating order, it meant that the local fishery could be managed by the local community. And in through that, they brought in a number of measures. They restricted the number of scallop dredges that could be put on each boat. And that meant that instead of having a few big boats, it meant that we have a larger number of vessels. So that helped to maintain and increase employment. The fleet was able to implement a range of conservation measures, which allowed them to gain MSC accreditation. So the Shetland scallop fleet is the only, was the first in the world to get a dredge fishery in the world to get accreditation, and that's helped them maintain a market advantage. to giving empowering communities for local control. Fishery communities across Scotland have declined. Fishing employment has declined, but it's helped to local control can help to prevent that loss of jobs. It's not just about job creation. Better management can prevent us from losing jobs. Conversely, we don't really have control of our own whitefish waters. And one of the reasons that, although I personally voted to remain in the EU, that a lot of fish communities didn't, is that they were told they'd have better management, and that management could have been greener. And one of the bugbears of the local community here is the international vessels putting long lines out, and which are lost and cause marine litter. They cause large numbers of entanglement of harbour porpoises. And so it's disincentivising for increased conservation measures by our Scottish fleet if the international community, from their perspective, aren't adhering to those aspirations. But also it's a lost opportunity for jobs. If Scotland took control of its quota more in a way that was promised but was probably never achievable, all of that fish stock that's being caught by international boats could be creating local employment in a more sustainable way than it is at the moment. And I believe that the SSMO and the inshore regulating order demonstrates how you can employment could be sustained, and in biodiversity targets can be reached by local by maintaining a fishery which is hasn't been achieved in our more offshore waters, and which is causing a range of impacts.
Ariane.
Thank you, Rachel, for that. I'm just going to come back to Danny and pick up on couple of things. One is, you, in terms of funding for your project, what kind of amounts of funding are we talking about, just so we understand, you know, for a coastal community to be doing a local restoration project? That's one bit. And the other bit is that I was actually in your area during my summer recess. I was on Lough Melfort, and I was talking to some folks who are running a restoration project on the other side, I think, of Lough Melfort, and I think they mentioned your work. And one of the things that they talked about was the difficulty of the planning process for bringing about their native oyster restoration. And I'd like to understand from you if that is a common issue, that the planning process is onerous, and what we need to be doing about that to support local planning authorities to be able to support these restoration projects.
Yeah, thank you. Well, just deal with your last point, firstly, about the planning and the licensing. If there are particular projects, you need to get a planning permission. You then need an aquaculture license.
Oh, no.
We look like we've lost Danny for the time being. The other witnesses are still available, so I'm going to move on to...
Depending on where you are, Crown Estate licence. You may then need a marine construction licence, and making it easier for communities. Can you still hear me? I'm sorry.
Yes, we can.
Danny, I don't know whether you can hear us. I'll tell you what we're going to do.
My phone.
We're going to move on to another witness at the moment to see if we can get your connection a little bit more stable. I'm going to move on to questions from Beatrice.
Thanks, Convener. Actually, Rachel has answered many of the questions I was going to put to her about the SSMO order. Rachel, you've already touched on, obviously, how important devolving down to the local communities has been in terms of the regulating order. You've also answered the questions that I was going to ask about gill netters and marine litter. So I just wonder, in general terms, we know that the whole regulating order is underpinned with scientific evidence and ongoing evidence. And I mean, I know of the work that goes on at the NAFC or the Marine Centre at Scalloway. I wonder if you could indicate what the impacts of that have been over the last few years on the marine environment and in terms of the climate emergency.
In terms of the climate emergency, I would the main benefit I would see is the closed areas, because those habitats are carbon sequestrating habitats. And I guess the benefit of having a strong inshore fleet is that it's a local fleet, so we're accessing local grounds from very close grounds. And some of our fishing methods, like the pelagic fleet, they're very low carbon food production methods. Fishing is one of the lowest carbon food production methods that we have. It's much lower than on land, and particularly the pelagic trawl approach, because it doesn't touch on the seabed, it's a very low fuel approach. So as we, as a nation, go further down that journey and look at how we can further reduce the carbon impact, fishing does have to be part of our food security, low carbon food security production methods.
Yeah, if I could ask a bit more about crowded seas in terms of renewables, offshore wind farms, and fishing, and how we can ensure that all sectors can work together. I wonder if you could say a bit more about that.
I mean, one of the things to ensure that impacts are minimised is ensuring we've got adequate evidence of where the fishing grounds occur. At the moment, it's often based on VMS pigs, but they position the boats every 2 hours. So the boat can, whilst it's kind of presumed that the boats travel in a straight line between those 2 hourly points, that's not necessarily the case. There is stronger evidence of where is being utilised at the moment can help reduce impacts. But as we move towards our targets of 100% energy from renewables, it will be difficult to avoid all impacts on our conflict between the two sectors, because inevitably they will take place in some of the fishing grounds. And the challenge for fishermen, there is a perception that they fish everywhere, but they do fish in very specific places. So if where it's possible to avoid those very specific places, obviously that's the most desirable outcome. But it isn't like it's been estimated they fish around 40% of the sea. So if we inadvertently place new technologies in that 40% that they fish, along with the necessary creation of marine protected areas, suddenly the amount they can fish in is getting squeezed, which is inevitably going to have impacts on our local fleets. But data and knowledge of where fishing boats fish is key to ensuring unnecessary conflict between emerging sectors and our existing uses.
That sectors are involved in the discussions that are going on, you know, communities feeling that things are being done to them rather than with them, and bringing people along.
Thank you. I've got some supplementaries from Karen, from Rachel, followed by Karen, Jenny, and then Mercedes.
Rachel, Michael Kaiser, the chief scientist at Heriot-Watt University, said it was time to find places where dredging scallops does the least damage to the environment. And I wondered how sort of simple that statement was when we're talking about protecting jobs and livelihoods.
Rachel.
I think there's definitely the opportunity for that. I mean, much of our seas are very dynamic, so you can find areas of the seabed where the sand is moving and can raise and fall, the sea floor can raise and fall by a couple of metres each year. So there are certainly opportunities to locations where the impact of dredging will be minimal versus the natural dynamic nature of the marine environment. Where I live in Shetland, our marine environment is very, very dynamic. So certainly many of the places that the scallop fleet are fishing would be very naturally disturbed. I realise that's not necessarily the case for the whole of the Scottish coastline, some of which is much less dynamic than Shetland. So I can only speak for the area in which I live. In terms of answering your question around Michael Kaiser's statement, I certainly think there's an opportunity to try and achieve what Mike Kaiser has suggested, that there are better places for different activities to occur, and more localised management might help identify where those are. In Shetland, we don't have you have fishing fleets which are local, and you have fishing fleets which are more that roam. We don't, because of the regulating order, we don't have roaming vessels that come here who might inadvertently damage habitats that they are unaware of. which is a different situation to the rest of Scotland because of the regulating order.
And Karen.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. How does the panel feel in light of their own experiences that we can improve on bringing together the private, public and third sector organisations really from across the globe to increase our knowledge of blue carbon and identify how to move from research to actual action? And are there any barriers that exist in terms of research and development that we should be aware of? Thank you.
Can we have Dr. Alistair Rennie to kick that one off, please?
specifically to do with blue carbon and private finance, I think from a coastal perspective, we are making good inroads on that. I think there's further opportunities to come. The work of SMEEF, which was previously alluded to by Danny, it's a project run by Nature Scott, the Scottish Marine Environmental Enhancement Fund, attempts to do this, to bring together public and private finance together. The challenges that we face not only are related to biodiversity loss or improvements to do with biodiversity, but also the sequestration. But I would echo the thoughts of our previous Cabinet Secretary, Rosanna Cunningham, when she talked about we need joint approaches. We can't have single approaches to only problems of mitigation and problems of adaptation together. We need to find those wonderful places within our marine and our coastal and terrestrial areas where we have both mitigation and adaptation benefits. So sequestering carbon better within our coastal systems provides those benefits from a mitigation perspective, but also from an adaptation perspective, because our challenge is both going forward. So there's new work coming and new funding coming, but we'll need more of it as time goes on.
And Danny.
Specifically about blue carbon, but my understanding is that 90%, 99% of the organic carbon in the sea is locked into the sediments. And if you look at our sea lock here, which is still dredged, and dredges come in, as I've said before, as far as they can. A lot of it is burrowed mud. They're dredging for scallops, they might be dredging for prawns. And that has been, up to date, a very, very efficient carbon sink. But every time you disturb it, it potentially becomes a carbon source. So there's a huge amount of research to be done on this. And if we're dredging up most of the Scottish sea logs, ripping through those ecosystems, then then it's not just a biodiversity problem, but it's also a carbon source problem. What I would say generally is that we need a whole ecosystem approach. There's a priority marine review that has been promised since 2019. That was a result of dredging of the Flame Shell Reef in Loch Arran, that then became an MPA. That was announced by the Scottish Government. It still hasn't happened. And that's just looking at priority marine features and looking at ways of protecting them. But a lot of the priority marine features in these inshore areas have now gone because they've been destroyed. The seabed has been destroyed. So if we want to bring back biodiversity, really we have to look at what's happening in Lamnash Bay and look at no-take zones and see that the seabed can recover very quickly to the benefit of many, to the benefit of fishermen, if they fish sustainably in the future. So I think we have to look at the whole ecosystem and not just look at in individual things. And it needs to be a joined up approach between all the agencies.
Thank you. And questions from Jenny.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel. It's been really informative. I'm kind of going back to the question that my colleague Rachel Hamilton asked. We got some evidence from academics 2 weeks ago, and there was a suggestion there, and it kind of goes on from what Rachel was saying, and to some extent Danny as well, that we can't keep oceans in one particular state. Nature will take over. And then also that we need to look at the overall protection of the ocean areas as opposed to focusing in on one area. So I'd be interested to hear a bit of an expansion on these two thoughts from your perspective. And Dr. Alistair Rennie, I believe part of the St. Andrew's Links Trust is collecting old Christmas trees and using them to stabilise the sand dunes at St. Andrew's. So anyway, sorry, just as an aside, I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on looking at the ocean as a whole. Dr. Rennie, thank you.
But I think St. Andrew's provides an interesting case study in how, and this is the same across our marine environment. There's a virtuous circle that's managed to have been created within the St. Andrew's area, whereby we have successful businesses that care about their environment, are investing in nature and nature-based solutions, and they're also bringing their community with them. And all of those parties are also appreciative of the natural environment which they have inherited. So a nice example of that is Fife Council collecting Christmas trees that are then stockpiled and made available. Instead of being shredded and put off to compost, they're taken and some of them are used to help stabilise some of the low parts of the sand dunes. And the sand is used from areas of the beach that have accreted over the previous years. So that's a nice example, but I would, across all of the panel, there are other areas where we need to foster that collaborative environment whereby science is being used in a tailored way to the local circumstances and supporting more resilient businesses that care more about their environment and help nature, but also keep us on the right track as far as managing those growing problems of increasing pressures from climate change, be they along the coastal edge or a little lower down in the marine environment.
Thank you. And Danny, I wonder if you could comment on my original statement about not being able to keep oceans in one state, nature will take over, if you've got any thoughts on that.
Well, yes, absolutely. I mean, as I mentioned before, that we know that the one no-take zone that exists in Scotland, and it's absolutely tiny, has proven that biodiversity returned very, very quickly to the benefit of everybody. And basically, that's what we need to do. We need to think about a just transition. We need to work with fishermen where their activities are problematic, and we need hopefully to bring everybody together to say our long-term goal is to sequester carbon in the long term, is to restore biodiversity in the inshore waters, and then work together to maintain that for the economic benefit of everybody. And you know, that's the way forward. It makes sense. I mean, Sweden is now trialing a 12-mile limit on bottom trawling off their coastline. Other countries are doing it. We should be doing it. We used to be one of the richest fisheries in the world. And now, you know, up the West Coast, we're just fishing at the bottom of the food chain. It's completely unsustainable and it is reversible and we should be doing it.
And I'll move on to Mercedes.
Thank you. I've got one question for Rachel and then a question for Danny, if there's time. So, Rachel, the Shetland Spatial Plan is held as an example of good practice. And I know that one aspect of it is that scallop dredgers are all fitted with tracking devices. So my question's got three parts. I was wondering, do you think that this tracking of scallop dredgers is a good thing? And do you think it ought to be rolled out to the rest of Scotland's inshore fisheries? And then finally, do you think the Scottish Government should be considering delegating powers to locally manage other inshore fisheries?
To answer your second question about the tracking, the one thing that tracking enables vessels to do is prove if they're adhering to the conservation measures they're benefiting from. And it also helps provide an evidence base when it comes to things like marine renewables. So there is benefits to the fleet for doing it. And also when boats are accused of not adhering to the measures, they can actually prove that they were adhering, for instance. So there's benefits of that as well. In terms of rolling out, I think it would be the Scottish Government, was my understanding, did have the aspiration of rolling out a system, and for a range of reasons that has been delayed. So I believe the Scottish Government does still intend for that to happen. And obviously, therefore, the cost and burden of that would be taken on by the Scottish Government, which I believe the SSMO has a preference for, and including the enforcement elements of it. So that would make a level playing field for the whole of Scotland. So, and in terms of, I guess, the other areas in Scotland, if they, I can see that there would be benefits for the IFGs to have more powers to replicate the successful model that they've had in Shetland with the SSMO. I guess one of the challenges of that in these increasingly difficult financial times is always going to be the resourcing at a national level, because we had things had become more financially challenging anyway, and now we've had COVID. So I imagine spreading our relatively limited taxpayers' money is always going to be a difficult political decision. And I'm sorry, I can't remember what your first question was.
The first question was just whether you think the tracking is a good thing. It sounds like you do.
Yeah, I think it was beneficial in terms of proving that the fishermen were adhering, which they did do, and then we could prove that they were doing it, which was, it helped with the evidence base.
Perfect. Thank you very much. And then I just wanted to fit in one question for Danny, if I can, now that we've got him back. So a couple of weeks ago, the committee heard about the lack of commercially viable whitefish stocks on the West Coast. And it's great that Sea Wilding's doing work to recover inshore ecosystems to provide better nursery grounds for fish species, but obviously that's restricted to the project at the specific lock. So I was wondering what Sea Wilding believe is needed to recover cod and herring stocks on the wider West Coast, if you have a view on that.
Well, one of the problems about the marine world is there's a lack of baseline surveys. And so, you know, the mel beds, the seagrass beds, all those rich habitats that used to be the spawning grounds for herring, for cod and things like that, we have an idea of where they were, but a lot of them have now been destroyed. So firstly, we need to understand where they still exist and then give them a proper protection. And, you know, my personal view is we need to give the whole inshore protection, because that is traditionally where the nursery grounds and the fish spawning grounds are. And the fact that, you know, there's the whitefish stocks are commercially extinct on the West Coast is, we have to look at the data, and there is a real correlation between the lifting of the 1984 inshore limit and then all the dredging is allowed right in, and then a collapse of the fish stocks within about 10 years. I personally remember aged about 6 going fishing for halibut and whiting and all these things off Tyree, about a mile off Tyree. It was called the Scarnish Bank. It was a community resource. It's where everybody went to get their whitefish. And then within a matter of years, it was destroyed by dredgers. So it's we need to understand where it was, and we need to understand how we can bring it back. And then to protect, we need to have meaningful marine protected areas to do that.
Thank you. I think you're suggesting about baselining information. I think it's a very general and broad statement to suggest that dredging has solely been the responsibility of destroying our inshore nurseries. And that's why the importance of baseline information to inform our decisions is so important. On that, just before we move away from Shetland, we see how Shetland has done a huge amount to address the crowded sea argument, to remove unnecessary conflict and whatever. And there is other areas in Scotland where the fixed fisheries and the trawling, the mobile gear fisheries work well together. So, for example, in the Solway Firth. But, Rachel, do you believe that we need legislation and additional funding to ensure that those successful partnerships are in place right across Scotland?
Yes, I imagine so, because for the Shetland Marine Planning Partnership is funded by the Scottish Government. So at the moment, there's Shetland and the Clyde and Orkney, which are currently in the process of developing plans and data, leading on from the previous point, data collection and mapping has been a really large part of that. But at the moment, there is a huge I think it would be a bad idea for the Scottish Government to have started all of the marine planning partnerships at once, so they didn't, so that was an opportunity for lessons learned. But the also that's the cost of having them all run at the same time, I think, has also been a barrier. There was originally a budget proposed to run all the marine planning partnerships at once, and that hasn't happened. It is my understanding that cost is an element of that decision making.
Okay, thank you very much. And we're finally going to move on to questions from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, convener. Questions for Dr. Rennie. I was interested in what some of our written evidence that we've received has said, and what evidence that's been discussed today has said about rising sea levels and about the need to prepare for that in terms of infrastructure. So I was just keen to hear a bit more about what you anticipated around the cost. You've mentioned, a figure of $1.2 billion between now and 2050 as a potential cost around infrastructure. Can you tell me a bit more about what that means?
Yes, very happy to. Thank you very much, Dr. Allen. The $1.2 billion figure is the headline number that came from the Dynamic Coasts National Coastal Erosion Risk Assessment. Under that, we took a precautionary baseline, which assumed that we continued on our high emissions, climate emissions trajectory that we are currently on for the rest of the century. And we also assumed that we didn't maintain any of the coastal defences that were in place at the moment. When we plotted the future erosion under that situation and then intersected or laid it on top of the extent of our road, railways, and residential properties, those three items together came to the value of £1.2 billion. So under a high emissions scenario, that's the potential exposure on roads, railways, and residential property, the three things we could cost readily. But on a low emissions future, if we achieve net zero quickly, that falls to £800 million. So the project demonstrates that there is a cost saving in direct avoided damage costs of around £400 million from net zero, which in and of itself is actually quite a helpful thing to know. More generally, however, and I'd encourage you looking away, or the broader picture is more important, if I may, in the fact that the evidence base is now available for different organisations to then make better judgments and better decisions on the back of it. So the data is being used by NatureScot, being used by SEPA, it's being used by Transport Scotland, it's being used by Scottish Water, it's being used by different local authorities to start to explore and plan ahead. Now, not all of these risks will be presenting themselves tomorrow morning. They'll be increasing into the future through time. So the monitoring and the risk assessments and the strategies that are then needed can and are being sort of worked forward as we plan ahead.
So would it be fair to say, given that you've looked at a limited range of things, roads, railways, houses, that there may be other costs that local authorities should anticipate? I'm thinking, I know I always quote this, but the example from my own constituency where a school had to be moved because as a direct result of rising sea levels. So what kind of other areas can you anticipate? I know they're not part maybe of that study, but what kind of other areas can you anticipate, and could they be costed?
Yes is the short answer. So the $1.2 billion came simply from the fact that we had the cost of the replacement of a length of a road, a railway, and residential properties are easily priced. What isn't easily priced is commercial property. What isn't easily priced is a length of water pipe. We have these data sets, we just don't have the costings associated with their replacements. So within the Dynamic Coast project and with our partners, we've received data from different organisations and on the back of that, we can do that risk assessment. So we have the numbers at least, and that's a step change as far as our understanding going forward. And that's essential to then build up. Each of these organisations have their own responsibilities, of course. So it's for local authorities to take forward that understanding and plan ahead. And that's what they're now able to do.
So you feel they're now able to do that? I mean, again, I'm not sure if this formed part of your remit, but do you see evidence that as yet organisations have been brought together to think about these questions in a strategic way that would look as far ahead as you are looking to 2050? Or
The very presence of the Dynamic Coast Project confirms that is the case. Our remit is to improve the evidence base and to support others in the delivery of their statutory obligations. In the same way that SEPA have flood maps and they're relied upon in local planning and for flood risk management planning and development planning, the same is also the case for coastal erosion mapping, increasingly, as was alluded to, that is expected within NPF4 and other policies. So we are getting there. The challenge is increasing, and increasingly we will have to step up. Over the last handful of years, there certainly has been an increased awareness and interest from local authorities. They've got responsibilities under the Coastal Protection Act, and they're certainly more interested and sort of active in this area. In the coming years, Scottish Government have secured funding and noted that within the programme for government to undertake coastal change adaptation funding and plans. And that work is ongoing, and other policy colleagues will be able to answer further questions on that. But that work's coming in the next few years to move this further forward.
And finally, convener, I'm interested to know whether you have a view on whether, I suppose, your comments are really mainly talking about adapting to this new reality rather than hard engineering solutions. But where do hard engineering solutions in coastal communities or communities by rivers, indeed, where do they fit into this plan and these costs?
So the challenges that we face are a mosaic. Yeah, climate change is a risk multiplier, and it will affect different parts of our country in different ways. We've looked specifically at the open erodible coast, because that's the thing we can model most readily with the science that we have available to us at the moment. But there are other risks, as you've alluded to. So rainfall intensity, for example, river flooding, these other pressures and other risks are also changing through time. And the responsibility, the organisations, local authorities, have got to manage that broader responsibility. I think we're moving in the right direction. And I think there is certainly more that can be done. We obviously, some parts of our coastal system have benefited from coastal defences over the years. For example, Scarra Brae. We wouldn't have Scarra Brae up in Orkney, a World Heritage Site, if we didn't have a sea wall. And I think we're all richer as a result of that. The problem with sea walls is they actually tend to reflect wave energy and scour the beach in front of them and cause erosion to appear on adjacent areas. So they need to be used proportionately and carefully in the appropriate places. Increasingly, adaptive approaches, there's a term called greening the grey, where we try to use softer nature-based solutions alongside traditional engineering methods, is an important thing. And we've realised that through our collaboration with international researchers. So there'll be a composite approach depending upon the local circumstances. In some places, we may need higher seawalls with bigger foundations. But we would need to use that sparingly. In other places, it's going to be more effective for us to adapt and avoid and to pick our fights. And in some places, we can buy some time by investing in nature and making our natural systems more resilient, absorb wave energy further away, stop flooding from penetrating quite so far into our areas. These buy time, but arguably, when we think about sustainability in the future, we want to be inherently sustainable, inherently resilient. And understanding how the landscape and our use of the landscape changes with time, that's the key to that. We don't want large repair bills going forward. And nature-based solutions are one tool in flexibly responding to that as we learn and do adapt to our future climate.
Thank you, Gabriel.
Thank you. Just very finally, I'm aware that some local authorities, as the responsible authority for the development of shoreline management plan and so on, my local authority in Dumfries and Galloway set out in a consultation in March to look at the challenges and to set out a list of policy options going forward. Is that something that you're involved in? And is there a national framework, if you like, for policy options and funding of pinch points, critical interventions that are required?
Yeah. Thank you, Convener. So I think what you're alluding to is the Shoreline Management Plan, which Dumfries and Galloway were developing and consulting on. Shoreline Management Plans take the coastal change information, which we have developed, and we've done the first part for them, in essence, which saves everyone a little bit of money, which is good. And they then basically develop local policy aspirations for different stretches of the coast. We have something important here. We need to hold on to it. We can't adapt. We'll maintain a seawall. In other locations, we'll have a non-intervention approach, for example. So shoreline management plans have been used in different parts of Scotland. We don't have full coverage, and that's a policy gap. However, there are improvements that are being realised through discussions and cross-organisational discussions at the moment about how we can improve that going forward. And again, I note the funding, the £12 million worth of funding from the Scottish Government, which is setting out exploring how we can do that most appropriately. It's a really important part of our resilience plan going forward, is how to get this, how to get the evidence forward, and then really take on board the local circumstances and the communities on how to keep and how to maintain that resilience, that protection from flooding, that protection from erosion, by being smarter, by picking our fights.
Thank you very much. And that brings us to the end of this session. And can I once again thank you all for setting time aside in your diaries, given the delay last week. It's very much appreciated, and we appreciate your very useful evidence. Thank you very much. We'll now suspend briefly until 10:40 to allow for a changeover in witnesses. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone, and a welcome to our meeting, our second panel, who will be discussing the role of the Scottish Public Agencies on Nature and Environment. And I welcome to the meeting Terry O'Hearn, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Environment Protection Agency, Grant Moyer, the Chief Exec Officer for the Cairngorms National Park Authority, Graham Melville, the Area Manager for Northern Isles and North Highland Nature Scott, David Sigourney, the Chief Exec of Scottish Forestry, and Andy Wells, Investment and Sales Programme Director for Crown Estates Scotland. And I invite Terry O'Hearn to make a brief opening statement, followed by Grant, Graham, and Dr. Sigourney, and then finally Andy Wells.
Thanks, convener, and thanks also for noting I have to leave early for an NHS appointment. Apologies to the committee for that. I guess the most important thing from CEPA's point of view in our contribution is a fundamental change in the way we're regulating. So if you think of what EPAs around the world have done in their first 20 or 30 years, it's the right thing, which is what I would call a mass transaction approach. So we go to lots of factories and other businesses and get them to improve their environmental performance, get them to reduce phosphorus discharges to a river or a lock, for example. That is still a fair bit of what we'll do. But if you think of how we can play a role in the next phase to improve the environment in general in Scotland, but in particular in terms of rural sectors and communities, it's to take a more systems approach. So if I just give an example to explain that, we regulate the whiskey sector, we regulate the barley growers. Now, in the first phase, we would do that pretty separately. We would just go to a distillery and make sure it met its license obligations, and we have general requirements for barley growers, and we do some farm inspections, etc. Actually, rural communities face the challenges of climate change. So, for example, water scarcity, which is becoming a more regular and prominent challenge for rural communities and those sectors in particular that are water dependent, how do we take a more systemic approach to sit down with the whiskey industry, the barley growers, etc., and say, how can we help you in your value chain and supply chain reduce water use? Because that will both help protect the environment and help reduce their risk, economic risk from water scarcity. So we've taken a new approach in having sector plans for the 34 sectors we regulate, where we can actually say, what's the challenge in this part of Scotland, or what's the challenge for this sector? And rather than just simply taking an individual side-by-side approach, saying there are systemic challenges in this rural part of Scotland, we regulate, let's say, eight of the sectors here. How do we take an approach to help them come up with systemic solutions to systemic problems? If I just give one other quick example, convener, we also have a sustainable growth agreement, which is our sort of blue chip voluntary agreement with Nestle down in the borders area. And what that does is Nestle want to reduce environmental impact in their supply chain. So they're working with dairy farmers, for example, in that area to help them reduce their environmental impact. So you're getting the benefit of, rather than, you know, in the worst case, a regulator beating people up, and we need to do that if people are really doing the wrong thing and refuse help. But actually what you've got is the regulator sitting down with the big company that the farmers sell their produce to, saying, how do we work together with the local authority, with other environmental experts, help these farms remain viable and reduce climate change risk and other types of environmental risks. So those two examples are trying to illustrate that in rural communities, if we can take a more systemic approach and a more partnership approach, yes, we will still regulate if people, you know, we will still wield the stick if people need the stick. But if we can make the bulk of our effort helping people in rural communities work out what the systemic challenges are and work in partnership on systemic solutions, we think we can make a stronger contribution.
Thank you very much, Terry. And I'll move on to Grant.
Good morning, everyone. And yes, so just to follow from Terry, the work of climate and nature is really at the core of the work that the National Park Authority does within the park. We have a new National Park Partnership Plan that's out for consultation at the moment, which covers nature, people and place. And that closes on the 17th of December, and that sets out long-term targets for the park going out towards 2045. In terms of the underpinning for that, there are two things we're doing at the moment I think will help us do that. So one is we've undertaken a carbon audit for the whole of the National Park, which will give us a benchmark as to where we are and where the key things are for us to focus on around emissions. And the other thing is the Cairngorms Nature Index work, which we're doing, which will give us ecosystem health in the Cairngorms and will give us a good benchmark as well. And that's important because we need to know where we are and we need to know where we have to focus on the key things going forward to deal with these things within the National Park. And then around that is a whole programme of work that allows us to actually do work on the ground to deliver. So things like peatland restoration, woodland expansion, river restoration, and all the things that we do around that within the Cairngorms Nature Partnership, which I think in partnership is one of the key things around this, which is working with a lot of different partners to try and make these things happen on the ground. So whether it's things like East Cairngorms Moorland Partnership, whether it's Cairngorms Connect, whether that's projects like rare invertebrates in the Cairngorms or rare plants or the CAPR project, these are all delivering on that bigger, wider Cairngorms Nature Partnership behind that. And one of the key things for us over the next few years is we've recently been successful in getting the Heritage Horizons funding from National Lottery Heritage Fund, which is for Cairngorms 2030. And that's a £40 million programme over the next 7 years, which is looking at how we do the work around climate and nature, and also things like public health and how we take people with us on that and how the climate impacts on communities and such like. So there's a whole focus on people, and ultimately we've got to take people with us in this journey. And it's, we know that we've got to do things at a bigger scale and at a faster pace, but we've also got, you know, we've got to take people who live within the park. So there's 18,000 people who live within the park. But also we know we get 2.1 million visitors each year. So how do we involve those as well? How do they get to the park? How do they transport around the park? All these sorts of things as well are key for us. So I think there's lots of opportunities within the park to try new things. And that's some of the work we're doing on things like the regional land use partnerships and how we actually make that work. The Heritage Horizon side of things, I think, again, is about trying new things and then taking that forward on things like private finance. And I think the whole opportunity for us is to use the park and the park plan to really generate, if you like, involvement by people in delivering on both nature and climate, which is at the heart of all the work that we do across all our work.
And we'll now move to Graham Neville.
Good morning, Convener, and thank you for the invitation to give evidence. Can I check you can hear me okay? Yes. Yep, thank you. As I said, I'm Graham Neville, the area manager for Northern Isles and North Highlands and Nature Scots, and I must pass on the apologies of Francesca Zoska, our chief exec, who is unable to join today because the board is meeting with our minister, Ms. Slater, this morning, so apologies for that. Our duty as a public body, a non-departmental public body, is to advise government and deliver the benefits of nature protection and restoration. We recognise that Scotland's nature is in a highly damaged state, with critical losses still being experienced over relatively short timescales. And we recognise that this continued degradation poses a significant challenge to achieving climate stability. So we think that the link between the nature crisis and the climate emergency is so strong, it makes no sense to tackle both separately. We know that if we restore the natural world, it can contribute as much as 30% of the carbon emissions reductions required to help us hit net zero by 2045. Excuse me. Transformation of our use of land and sea is one of the most significant ways we can address the nature and climate emergency. And rural Scotland and the islands, including our marine and coastal habitats, as we heard earlier in the panel, have a particularly important role to play. But for our rural communities, our farmers, crofters, fishers, investment in nature also means opportunities for green jobs, new businesses. This includes the tree planting, restoring peatlands, natural flood defence projects and greening settlements. These sorts of nature-based solutions reduce our emissions and restore nature, but they do provide significant employment opportunities. Currently, there's about 200,000 jobs in the nature-based sector. That's about equivalent to the numbers employed in the oil and gas sector. Most of these are in rural and island communities. The anticipated growth in jobs required in order to implement nature-based solutions to the climate emergency will provide a strong basis for green recovery, and spread across Scotland's remote and rural communities can really help us meet the needs of a just transition. We do realise that one of the drivers of biodiversity loss is our overall approach to the economy. We see nature as something outside of the economy, whereas in reality, our economic well-being sits within nature. Scotland will only be a prosperous nation if it's sustainable in the widest sense. The biosphere underpinning economy and society, as referenced in the recent Treasury report on the economics of biodiversity by Professor Dasgupta. Achieving such true sustainability will help us navigate a just transition to a net zero nation, one which helps us limit global heating to 1.5 degrees and allows us to adapt to the impacts of this level of warming, which are already built into the system, making us more resilient to these changes that are now unavoidable. So in NatureScot, we are working on our priorities for what we can do in the most impactful way over the next corporate plan period for NatureScot, but towards the 2030 horizon to restore biodiversity, build in climate resilience. And one of the ways we directly do that is by working with the rural sectors and economies spread across rural Scotland and the islands. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And we'll now move on to Dr. David Signorini, please.
Thanks very much, convener, and thanks for the opportunity to be here today to talk about the climate and nature emergencies and what Scottish Forestry is doing to tackle them. I should explain that since it was fully devolved and created in 2019, Scottish Forestry has been an executive agency of the Scottish Government with close working relationships to key policy areas such as biodiversity, agriculture and climate change. And these relationships are really helping us to coordinate and prioritise our own work. As COP26 highlighted, protecting, restoring and expanding forests is absolutely vital to tackling the twin crises. And that action needs to take place both globally, for example, through the Glasgow Declaration on Forests, and locally here in Scotland. As the committee know, we have very ambitious woodland creation targets rising over the next few years to 18,000 hectares per year. And we also have a statutory commitment in the 2018 Act to promote sustainable forest management based upon internationally recognised principles and applying to all forests and woodlands, old and new. Scotland's forestry strategy is a 10-year framework setting out how we will achieve that and ensuring that all of our forests, the existing ones and the new ones we're creating right now, deliver environmental, economic and social benefits. Our forests and woodlands cover nearly a fifth of Scotland's land. They're home to some of our most iconic animal and plant species, and they contain within them internationally important habitats such as the Atlantic rainforest. They sequester over 6 million tonnes of carbon dioxide a year, and they support around 25,000 jobs across Scotland, many of them in rural communities. And last but absolutely not least, they provide fantastic green spaces for people to visit and explore, where they can enjoy nature, meet friends and look after their physical and mental health. So Scottish Forestry, we're working to create more forests, to create better forests and to get more value of all kinds from those forests. That's what we're doing to help tackle the climate and nature emergencies, and I look forward to talking more about that over the next hour or so. Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, Andy Wells.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, committee. Thank you for this opportunity to again share with you the role of Crown Estate Scotland in battling these twin emergencies. Crown Estate Scotland, as many of you know, our core purpose is investing in property, natural resources and people to generate lasting value for Scotland. As an organisation, Crown Estate Scotland manages the Scottish Crown Estate, which includes a range of different assets, the length and breadth of Scotland, including obviously management of the seabed out to 12 nautical miles, fish farming agreements, cables and pipeline agreements, etc. The foreshore as well is included in that, with agreements for moorings and activities in ports and harbours, the rights to offshore energy, which is obviously a key area in this whole approach to Scotland's ambitions towards net zero. Of course, we play a major role in all of that, and carbon storage potentially out to 200 nautical miles. Also, the rural estate is quite key in relation to our activities in relation to rural land management, forestry and other activities. Agricultural tenancies are a key part of our management, including rights to wild salmon fishing and trout as well. A key element of our roles in relation to the management of the Scottish Crown Estate are as our investor, an enabler, and an asset manager, and a coordinator. And this is quite key because we don't manage land directly, and we're certainly looking at how we can use those roles more effectively in our activities and our business relationships with our tenants, and how we can invest, how we can enable a change within our tenants' businesses, and how we can manage our agreements with those tenants in order to facilitate change. Within our corporate plan, we have key strategic objectives to promote new sustainable ways of using natural resources. And this has a particular emphasis on the climate and nature emergency, but also how to involve people, particularly communities, in how land, coastline and seabed are managed. It is about those enabling roles that we have, particularly when it comes to working with our tenants. And as Grant mentioned, partnerships are key to the work that we do as well, working with other public agencies, working with our tenants particularly, but also communities and third sector bodies. And this is where we're really focusing our activity in relation to how we address these two key issues. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're now going to move on to questions from members, and we've got approximately 80 minutes for that. I'm going to kick off. Can I ask you how your role has changed as awareness of climate and nature emergencies issues has increased? And what changes have you seen to your organisations in recent years to enhance your responses to these challenges? And are there any barriers to making those changes? And can I start with Terry Ahern, please?
So the two main changes I've seen are a significant increase in general understanding of the climate and nature crisis. So, 5 years ago, if we were to talk to any business or any community, of course, there would be a level of understanding, but it's massively increased. And people see it as a core issue. It's no longer a sideline issue, it's a mainstream issue. That's the first thing. What that means is, I think for an organization like SEPA, we have to adjust because I keep talking about these two phases of an EPA's history. In the first phase, we would mainly deal with environmental managers at a business. In the second phase, if you're talking about corporate entities, we're in boardrooms, executive rooms. If you're talking about farming communities, the NFUS will have serious committee discussions about these types of issues. So we have to adjust as an organization to, as I said earlier, being systemic in our approach. No one can decarbonize or tackle the nature crisis on their own. So if you think of decarbonizing, any community, whether it's rural or urban, can do a certain amount. I mean, you can just use less energy in your home or on your farm or in your business. But unless you've got people providing renewable energy, you'll only make a certain difference. Unless a regulator is prepared to say, okay, you're trying to innovate. That's what we're increasingly finding, that people in communities are trying to innovate to tackle the combined climate and nature crises. We have to adjust because what a regulator tends to do is say, here are the rules, stick to them and mitigate risk. Well, the biggest risk is not having a go at big change and innovation. So if we go to any community and say, these crises are huge, these combined crises, you get it. Now, you want to innovate and try something different on a farm or in a local town, and we say, oh, no, that's too risky, that might not work. Well, that's not going to help people in Scotland. So what we need to do is not be cavalier. There are laws that people need to stick to, but we need to, I guess, have more of a risk appetite in saying, let's get communities and businesses together and say, right, what are the innovations that will turn around the decline of species and habitat that will help us decarbonize, and work out ways to support that innovation with the right, safety net mitigation around it. I think that's moving from the changes we're seeing to, I wouldn't describe it necessarily as a barrier, but we will become a barrier unless we can rise to that challenge.
And Graham Nelville, please.
like Terry, we have also really seen a huge increase in the awareness and understanding of the issue, but particularly from our perspective, the role of nature in being a solution to a climate emergency. In the run-up to, and of course during post during COP26, the focus on nature-based solutions and just the hits in terms of our awareness of the role of nature in providing a solution to carbon mitigation, sequestration, and also providing those biodiversity benefits has really, really increased. And these conversations that we are having across Scotland and internationally to look at how we can provide a significant part of the answer to Scotland's journey to net zero is very encouraging. I think there are some issues around the scope for collaboration. As Terry was saying, you know, we must have larger, bigger projects with more communities and more stakeholders. True multi-stakeholder partnerships at a landscape scale, for example, being a really key way of actually achieving significant increase from the 3% climate emissions reductions that we've managed to achieve in the more traditional route to date to the 9% that we're going to need moving forward. And I think that does reflect the change in the scale of work that we need to be looking at.
Thank you. And finally on this, Dr. David Cinerini, please.
Yes, I think I would make 2 points on that question, Convener. I think the increasing public awareness of the crises and the emergencies that has clearly led to an increase in interest in tree planting. I think what we're seeing is trying to take that conversation and that those good intentions further and say tree planting is a positive thing. But it really needs to be about woodland creation and the right tree in the right place for the right reasons. So there's a huge public support and public awareness of the benefits of tree planting. And I think we're trying to take that forward into woodland creation and the longer term development and management of those woodlands. The second point I would make is that one of the big changes I see in forestry are the structural changes from the completion of devolution of forestry and the creation of Scottish Forestry as an agency and Forest and Land Scotland, and the 2018 Act giving the Scottish Parliament a chance to influence how forestry is regulated and managed in Scotland and to integrate that more closely with the other regulatory agencies like CEPA and Nature Scot.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on to a question from Mercedes. Just before we do, how do you get the balance? Because when we're looking at, most people accept that increase in forestation is going to help us get to net zero. But where do we find the balance between potentially a monoculture of Sitka spruce and the right tree in the right place? What work's been done to ensure that actually is just not a phrase that people like to throw about, that we are actually seeing the best tree for carbon sequestration, we're seeing the best tree for biodiversity, and we're not just looking at commercial arguments for planting as many Sitka spruce as possible. Can I first go to David and then to... I'm sorry, I can't read the names. Graham, please.
Yeah. I think I'm. Can you?
Yes, go ahead.
Great. I would say that characterization is perhaps is how forestry was and how how forestry was done in the 80s and 90s. For at least the last 10 years, we've had the UK forestry standard in place. And that sets out the requirements for woodland creation. Productive forests will have a majority of productive species like Sitka spruce, but they are limited to a maximum of 75% of one species. They are required to take into account a whole range of other outcomes, such as biodiversity, public access, climate change. So the modern forests that are being designed and planted now should be they are not monocultures, and I think they may be primarily for productive timber. They may be for more native planting for greater levels of biodiversity. But you're absolutely right. We are constantly thinking about the balance between the economic, environmental, and the social outcomes of all the applications that come to us.
Thank you. And Graham, just commenting on that, do you think the balance is right with the UK forestry plan and Scottish forestry ambitions? Do they conflict with your main objective to protect biodiversity? Are they getting it right?
I don't think there's a conflict at the policy level. And there are very, very few issues where we've had site issues. They are not normally resolvable through dialogue between Scottish Forestry and ourselves at the local level. And I think, you know, the outcome is always about the best vision for a landscape or for a particular forest. And the irony of me giving evidence is that I've spent much of the last couple of years of my career removing trees from the flow country in order to enhance peatland restoration. So perhaps not the best person to comment, but there are absolutely good examples where we've moved from that monoculture, Sitka plantation to native woodland, riparian planting, which has biodiversity benefit, has economic benefit, and provides nature-based solutions, for example, even for fishery industries, for trout fishing. So I mean, I think at the national scale, the correct policies are in place, and we do work closely with our Scottish Forestry colleagues to help implement them.
Thank you. Now move on to questions from Mercedes.
Thank you. Good morning to the panel. On the theme of the role of public bodies in the climate, tackling the climate and nature emergencies, I had a question for Terry. So a coalition of wildlife campaigners previously highlighted there was a 40% reduction in funding for Scotland's public environmental bodies, including CEPA, from 2010 to 2019. So I was wondering how these cuts have impacted on CEPA's ability to respond to the climate and nature emergencies, and what's been the impact of the cuts in terms of staffing and CEPA's capability to undertake investigations and enforcement of action.
So, yeah, I've seen that submission, and it's about overall funding to the public bodies you talk about. In terms of CEPA, I mean, the funding we get is the funding we get. The key thing we've focused on is the business model change. So this, I keep coming back to operating in a phase one way to a phase two way. So for example, rather than doing lots of inspections of small operators, if you do a number of inspections, get enforcement results and publicise them widely through the sector, you're likely to get a more significant increase in compliance than you might with the previous approach. So I guess what we're doing in the way we're operating is we are setting out to use a different way of working, which for whatever resources we get, we're able to do our job in terms of compliance and enforcement. Now, for the first time ever, we've set up a dedicated enforcement team. So what we previously had was, I guess, jacks of all trade. So people would write a license, people would do the inspections, people would do the enforcement. Now that still exists to some extent, but even with fewer resources, you can get better returns if you have dedicated specialists. So what would happen would be, for example, someone might write a prosecution brief once in a 3 or 4 or 5 year period, because that's our highest level of enforcement. We now have a debt, and they, you know, it would take them longer. They mightn't get it right. Coffers might reject it because it's not quite good enough, and that's to be expected when you have that sort of model. Now, with the dedicated team, As we saw last week with a very successful prosecution for waste transfers, we actually, with the resources we got, we think we can be more effective on enforcement. So the approach we're taking is with, and I will always say, whatever resources we get, we will deploy for maximum benefit. With the resources we've got, we're confident we can do not just the same job we used to do, but an even stronger and better job across the areas you're talking about, everything from supporting innovation through to taking enforcement when we need to. And we think that, that's a natural point in time. It's not about resources. We would make this change anyway. So the focus of this is when you didn't have people thinking about the environment much, when the only influence on them was what the regulator did, then you had a certain approach, and this phase one approach was the right approach for the time. Scotland's environment is better than it would have been without that approach, as are all other places that have had an EPA. The right approach now, when you're facing more systemic challenges and banks are requiring environmental conditions in loans to businesses we regulate, et cetera, is to say you don't just keep using the old approach, which was high resource and effective for the time. You say, how do you redirect your resources in a way that suits the environment, for want of a better word, in which you're operating?
Thank you. We're now going to move on to look at priorities and ongoing work programme and kick off with questions from Ariane.
Thank you, Convener. And good morning, panel. It's good to have you here giving evidence. So in the last panel, witnesses made the point that there needs to be a joined-up approach across all agencies to tackle climate mitigation, adaptation and biodiversity simultaneously. And Terry, you've been talking about how SEPA is taking a more systems-based approach. But I'd like to ask the panel whether your organisations are endeavouring to work together in a joined-up approach. And if you are, could you provide some examples? And I'd also like to hear from you what the Parliament could do to help you support rural sectors to respond to the climate and nature emergencies. So maybe we'll start with, spoiled for choice here, maybe we'll start with Grant, because we haven't heard from you yet.
Thanks for that. And I suppose partnership working is at the core of what the Kingdoms National Park Authority does. So I mean, I can give you a couple of examples of working with organisations that are on the call. So for instance, we're working with Crown Estate Scotland, looking at the future of the Glenlivet Estate, which is Crown Estate land within the Cairngorms National Park. And we're working with Murray Council and Highlands Isles Enterprise, Crown Estate and ourselves, local community and other, to start looking at future long-term management of that estate and how that works in terms of both climate, nature, economy, planning, the whole thing together. So that's one example. A second example might be working with, we're very close with Scottish Forestry on woodland creation in the national park, and it sort of links back to some of the things that, that Dave was just saying. You know, we've got a target in the draft park plan for 35,000 hectares of new woodland in the park by 2045 in the draft plan, and that would take us from about 17% of tree cover to about 23% of tree cover in the national park. And at the moment, we're doing about 1,000 hectares of woodland per annum within the park, and we work very closely with the team from Scottish Forestry to do that. And we've got a woodland challenge fund scheme that we run, which helps people to do some of the prep work. And then obviously the Scottish Forestry come in and have their grants for taking forward the work on the ground. So there's lots of examples, I think, of where the organisations working together. And the main thing for me within the park is that the park plan binds that all together. So it binds together all the different aspects of trying to deal with these issues, from transport to planning to housing, to public health, through to some of the more nature-based solutions that we've been hearing about previously. So it's that whole system approach, and the park plan and having a document that actually sets out where we're going and how that all links together works very well. And obviously all public bodies within the national park have to have regard to that plan. So it's a key instrument for making sure that all that does fit. And I think there's some really good examples of how those partnerships work within the park and for the future in terms of delivering, as I said, at a greater pace and a greater scale in the future.
Thank you for that. That's really interesting. Is there anyone else who'd like to talk about joined up approach across organisations?
Andy Wells.
Hello, yes, I can. From Crown Estate's point of view, I think I mentioned at the beginning, partnership working is absolutely key to what we do. There's a range of examples. We've also gradually building up our capacity within our team for partnership working. We have partnership manager and recently employed new engagement managers working in Highlands and Islands, but also in the Moray area. Grant mentioned the work we're doing with the National Park in relation to Glenlivet in that particular location. We've also got a number of other projects that we've worked on, knowledge exchange partnerships with the Morden Research Institute, looking at particularly how we can build up understanding and awareness in our farming community and agricultural tenants in relation to livestock management, disease control, carbon mitigation, etc., which is, again, working directly with private sector and linking research institutes. We've done work previously on trialling the Natural Capital Protocol in partnership with CEPA and NatureScot, looking at how that protocol can be adapted to work at an estate and farm level. And those trials are, you know, again, informing how that whole approach to mitigating and adapting to the twin crises can be tackled at a business level within farm businesses, in dairy and in livestock and in an arable farm. We've trialled all three. We've done work in relation to our new challenge funds, which are a capital investment funds, again, our investment role, looking particularly where we can make investment and working in partnership with projects around Scotland. The boat-based tourism one was launched earlier this year. We've also launched a partnership fund, which particularly is deliberately targeted at working directly with communities, our tenants and other bodies. And then in the new year, we'll be launching the Innovation with Natural Resources Capital Fund. So we have a lot of examples of where we're working directly in partnership with bodies around this table, third sector bodies and communities.
Thank you for that. Does anyone else want to come in, maybe in the interest of time, kind of like highlights? Terry, and then David.
Yes, probably our best partnerships are in the Leven catchment, where there are 16 signatories to a sustainable growth agreement, public bodies, NatureScot, Scottish Water, Scottish Enterprise, Fife Council, as well as private businesses, NGOs, etc. Your question about what could the Parliament do to help and support, that's our most promising partnership. Money's flowing in, people are investing in regenerating that part of Scotland. It's a harder way to work. Like, it's riskier, it's more challenging, it's more difficult, but therefore it's more rewarding for the community. And I think if the Parliament could support agencies in taking those risks to genuinely work in partnership, not just have bits of paper that say we are, but genuinely work in partnership with communities, third sector businesses and each other, that would be a big help.
Thank you for that, Terry. And David?
Yes, thanks. I would agree with everybody else. It's not possible for us to work in isolation, and it's absolutely essential that we work in partnership. Some examples, at a project level, when there are new applications for afforestation or large-scale fellings, then we do have a statutory, there's a set of statutory consultees, including NatureScot, Historic Environment Scotland, and CEPA. So we consult very formally on a case level, but we also convene a regular group as Graham described, at the national policy level, to talk about how, not just the individual cases, but how are we working in partnership more generally. Grant already talked about our work with the park. The one other example I would give is the Clyde Climate Forest, which is the 8 local authorities in the Glasgow City region, and that's their initiative to increase levels of tree cover in the urban environment and forest cover more generally. And that's perhaps a slightly less traditional form of collaboration, but that again is another example of partnership working.
Thank you for that. It's good to hear that innovation is happening. Did the other person want to come in? Or?
I've
got another question.
You've got another question.
So thanks for that. This is actually for, I think it's for Terry, it's for CEPA, yes. So this is, I can just find it. So this is, echoing the findings of the last session of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee and the Eclair Committee, the government's shared policy program states that the status quo of aquaculture regulation is not an option and includes a commitment to reform the regulatory and planning framework. That starts with this independent review from Professor Griggs that we're waiting for the first piece of that from him. Since SEPA's responsibilities include managing the environmental impact from fish farms, I'd appreciate hearing about your engagement with the review, whether you believe that it will catalyze the regulatory reform that is desperately needed, and what else is or should be being done to minimize the impact on the environment from fish pollution and reduce the considerable animal welfare harms across the industry.
So over the last 3 or 4 years, we've made a number of changes to the way we regulate the salmon industry. So we've tightened compliance requirements, we've changed and increased monitoring requirements on the businesses themselves and modernised those. They were best practice at the time, but were out of date. We've changed the way we monitor and inspect. So we've started an increase in unannounced inspections, for example. It's been challenging with COVID because making our boats COVID secure is even more difficult than making an office COVID secure, but we found ways to try and do that. And we've done other things such as, you know, I keep talking about the change in the way we operate. Each fish farm will have, fish farm company will have a number of fish farms. We still have individual site licenses, but we've assigned a person to coordinate all our interactions with company by company. That means if the companies want to say, we want to close these three sites because they're in more sensitive waters and have one bigger site over here under our changed arrangements, we've got a more nimble way of working out how to facilitate that and see if it actually can be allowed. We've also, for the first time ever, created a multi-stakeholder advisory committee. From what I understand is this hasn't happened in Scotland before, so it's just on our responsibilities, but we have the Coastal Communities Network, Environment Link, the Trade Association for the Fish Farmers, a couple of their companies, the local authorities, Nature Scott and others around a table. I wouldn't say it's the easiest meeting I chair every quarter because the views are so disparate and polarized, but it's actually trying to, you know, what the committee saw in its hearings was the very strong views about fish farming from many parties. So as a regulator, we're saying, well, we regulate a couple of key things, which you referred to in your question. We will get these people around a table to give us advice on how we should be regulating our particular responsibilities. So trying to say to them, instead of having a fight fish farm by fish farm, come in, talk to us, have a lively discussion. We'll try and work out what to do. So coming out of that are things like, can we with Marine Scotland and others develop a map for the West Coast, which says, don't even think about fish farms here, here and here. In these circumstances, a fish farm's more viable, or a fish farm's viable with this sort of technology, et cetera, and try and get everyone's input so you can get a more systemic approach. I've met with Professor Griggs as part of his inquiry. We are putting in a written submission. We await to see what his outcome will be. So obviously I met with him, put my views about what we're doing, what we thought could help, and we've put in some written thoughts. So I don't know what his report will find.
Very much. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Just before we move on, just on that same talk about enforcement and whatever, you know, there's a suggestion that SEPA has gone a bit soft, that you've lost your teeth. We had issues with flaring at Grangemouth. There is an argument for carrot and stick, but when we hear that the leakages of sewerage from Scotland's water system has risen by 40%, Are you losing your stick and there's too much trying to work with companies and not enough enforcement? Could that be a claim validly laid at your door, Terry?
For the first time ever, we've got a dedicated enforcement unit. We saw the value of that with a major prosecution result. We stopped a company sending appalling waste to China. We made the ships turn around and come back, and we prosecuted them in court. We have referred ExxonMobil for prosecution. We've required them to spend £140 million to stop the flaring. They've already put in new elevated tips. By the end of next year, they will have put in ground flare tips. So for me, the way you regulate properly is if people do the right thing, want to innovate and improve the environment and their profitability and the value that they provide to the community, the regulator should be supportive and helpful. If people don't want to do the wrong thing, then we should kick them, and we should kick them hard. And I want to kick them harder than we have in the past.
Thank you. That's quite clear. Move on to questions from Rachel and then Karen.
Thank you, Convener. And it was on that point, actually. In a report to board members in February, Mr. Ahern, you made the comment that there may be a risk of not protecting the Scottish environment, especially from key threats. So I wondered what might be your revised overspend and timescale required to deal with the impact of the cyber attack, particularly with regard to the environment?
So we are confident that what we've done since the cyber attack is do the highest priority work. So it's been incredibly difficult. I don't think you can understand what a cyber attack's like until you've been through one. So incredibly challenging for our staff. I would give them great credit, as well as great credit to a number of organisations that have helped us, including a lot of businesses we regulate who have been very good in helping us work out how to get them to comply. So if you think about what we've done over this year, we have never once failed to get a flood warning and alert out. So that's quite critical, because that's actually, in the worst cases, life and death. We haven't failed in any case to get the flood warnings and alerts out. We've made over 5,000 authorization decisions for businesses. Now, that's been difficult, but actually it's improving the way we do that work, because we found new and better ways to do it. We identified, not just from the cyber attack, but during the pandemic. Obviously during the pandemic, like most organizations, we had to restrict people going out in the field. Now, we don't have much restriction on field work now, as the evidence has come in that outdoor transmission of the virus is not that high. But what we did was we identified the highest priority risk sites to the environment, the highest risk sites to the environment, and prioritized attending those sites. So I won't go into all the stats we've got on what we've done during this year, but we're confident that we have addressed the highest priority environmental risks. My aim is that by the end of the next financial year, not only will we be fully back up and running, but actually we will be much more advanced. We had about a 4 or 5 year reform program. So by the end of next financial year, we will have fast-tracked that and put all the key elements in place. Now, as we do that, we are also delivering. So I'm confident that there aren't risks out there to the environment now that we can't deal with. We're still using some workarounds because we decided not to rebuild our old IT systems because we wanted to replace them anyway. We didn't want the opportunity provided by cyber criminals to have to do it under this sort of pressure, but we're building a completely new system. And for example, 3 of our mass transaction authorizations have now been made digital. So instead of a whole lot of paper going back and forward, there are 3 types of transactions which are at the leading edge of digital service provision. What that does is we mean all those decisions get made quicker. What are we doing with the same staff time? We can get out and deal with where we think the environmental risks are. So we will, for our business plan for next year, we will lay out that progress that we'll make. But again, I want to assure the committee, we're confident that the highest environmental risks, we've found ways to deal with, and we will continue to find improved ways of dealing with as we build to that new future.
Can I just clarify, you can receive, verify and determine applications for many industrial pollution permits and waste management?
Yeah, so initially that was difficult, but there is there's only one small category where we're still finding it a little bit challenging, but we're just working with the operators to do that on a case-by-case basis. So yes, for a number of months now, we've been able to determine any application that comes in.
Panel, are you confident that rural communities have a voice and are clear about the objectives and targets, particularly in relation to climate change, set by the Scottish Government?
and delivered by yourselves as public agencies? And what do you do to engage and consult with rural communities? Shall I start with Dr. Signori?
Yes, thank you. I mean, on the subject of consultation with rural communities, when we do have applications for new forests to be created through the forestry grant scheme, then one of the requirements of the UK forestry standard is that the applicants have done some community engagement in advance of that application coming through. So there is a requirement, and we will expect to see evidence of engagement with the local community, with the neighbouring landowners. When the application comes in, we have a public register, and the application will be put on that public register for at least 28 days. So the local community and the interested stakeholders will have another chance to feed in their comments on the particular application. So it's almost a two-stage process for us. There's a sort of less formal process of consultation through the UK forestry standard, and then there is the second formal aspect to it. And I think that does give the local communities an input and a voice on the individual schemes.
Is it, just to be clear, is it a bit like a planning process that local communities can feed back into? You said there's a public register, so I mean, do you keep track of how many complaints there are? Just scanning the feeling about forestry plantations at the moment, I noted that there was a resident from Loch Maben had said that wildlife is being decimated because of commercial planting. Forestry is destroying upland ground. You know, there's quite a strong public feeling out there, and I was wondering whether you were content with the engagement, considering that there were headlines like that.
I think there are examples of good public engagement, and there are examples of less good public engagement, and we are always encouraging and reminding applicants of the benefits of good community engagement, because in the pre-application phase, when the new forests are being designed, community engagement and local conversations can really help improve the design. As I said, one of the aspects of the standard is based around public community and public access, and we have examples of schemes where during the design phase the local community has been involved, and the less productive elements of the woodland have been essentially used as a to create a new community resource. So I think I come back to my point that there are some good examples, and there are some examples where perhaps the community engagement hasn't been as good as it could be.
Could I go to the Crown Estate now, please? Andy Wells, please.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes. Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, again, collaboration and consultation with communities is key to a lot of our work. And as I mentioned, it's a key part of our corporate plan to engage communities and our tenants in decision-making in relation to our activities. Just some examples, our corporate plan, obviously we're still a relatively new body, established in 2017, and the Scottish Crown Estate Act only came into force in 2019. But our consultation on our first corporate plan was extensively consulted on, included a lot of response from the communities around Scotland who we deal with. We directly engage with our agricultural tenants through a working group, a representative group with elected representatives from those estates from all our four rural estates we meet with them regularly and have a range of topics with which we discuss with them in relation to what's going on in terms of the rural estate management. You may be aware, some of you, that we've piloted local management pilots with around Scotland in advance of the implementation of the parts of the Act around transfer and delegation to look at local community and local authority involvement in management of Scottish Crown Estate. And we've got a pilot agreement in place with a number of bodies, including Orkney Islands Council and the 4th District Salmon Fishery Board. We also have, again, sort of regular consultation events when looking at things like long-term forest plans at Glenlivet, and the master planning project that Grant and I have mentioned will again involve a key element of community consultation, looking at sort of ecological land use and built development master plan for the Glenlivet estate. So it's something that we are very focused on. And certainly when it comes to things like our investment role and for the challenge funds, we're looking at working closely in partnership with those communities that come forward with projects, development trusts, et cetera, within that funding stream.
Thank you. I believe Graham and Grant would like to come in the back of that.
Thank you very much. I think the member's question is a very good one, because it cuts to the heart of the just transition, and the community involvement and engagement is absolutely key to that. I think Nature Scot and predecessor organisations have a long history of transactional engagement and consultation, particularly in our relationship to our statutory role on designated sites, protected areas, through our species and habitat management schemes, and joint delivery of the Agri Environment and Climate Scheme. But what I think is quite an exciting opportunity, something that is we're seeing increasingly happen, is that we must move into this sort of co-creation of a vision for a landscape scale. What does a landscape look like? What does a net zero landscape look like? What does a nature rich landscape look like? How do we get towards that? And we can only do that in full and true collaboration with stakeholders, with communities, in a true joined up fashion. And it's interesting that these will not necessarily be the same groups or the same solutions in the same place. There'll be spatial differences, and that's already being borne out by some of the landscape scale pilots. I mentioned the Four Country earlier, there's the Tweed Forum, there's a whole range of pilots and indeed Cairngorms Connect where a larger group of stakeholders can come together and set that vision. And I think what's really important here is that the rural sector are absolutely key to that. Our farmers, our crofters are the solution to the nature crisis and the climate crisis. And so we can only achieve true sustainability and net zero by working with them, co-creating and bringing with us.
Thank you. And Graham. I beg your pardon, Grant, sorry.
Yeah, no problem. I was just going to just add to that, which I think there's something about consultation versus, I suppose, dialogue type things that are happening. I think that's probably, there is always going to be the formal consultation side of things. So, for instance, we've got the National Park Plan out for consultation at the moment, and there's been over 700 responses to that so far, which is great to see. And this past week I've been on online events with farmers in the park, with businesses in the park, with communities in the park. We have regular residents meetings on visitor management stuff within the park. And actually, one of the things that the pandemic's done, strangely, is because a lot of these things have gone online, we're getting more people and more representation more easily than the old format of physical meetings and come to a village hall and that sort of thing. So actually, there's quite a bit of increase in dialogue, I think, around that. But I think the bit behind that is within the park. We've been working with community development trusts across the park for the past 15 years. They've all got community action plans. We then work with them to try and make those things happen. And we also support community development officers in the park through things like Voluntary Action Bannockstrass Bay or the Tomtown Glenlivet Development Trust. So there's not just, I suppose, the dialogue is absolutely necessary, but you then also need to have the infrastructure around it to actually make the things that people want to see happen start to happen. There's no point talking to people and consulting people and then ignoring what they say. So I think it's that listening side of things. It's about dialogue, and it's more than just the sort of traditional consultation. And if we're going to tackle some of these big issues that we have in front of us, and we know we've got to do it quite quickly, that whole thing about how do we take people with us is going to be absolutely critical. And that means having lots and lots of conversations and dialogue to try and find the right way forward. That means that we can do that together.
That's finished, Rachel. Thank you. We'll now move on to Karen.
Thank you, Convener. I feel like I have a few questions, and I feel like a lot of them have been answered. So I suppose I'd like to ask something a bit topical, if I may. And, you know, front and centre in my mind at the moment, which is really affecting my constituency, is Storm Arwen. And really, we've spoken quite a bit about collaborative working. You know, there's many issues affecting us here in Scotland, and particularly in my constituency, due to climate change. And that is, you know, we have migrating cod, I have our urban gulls issues, and now we have this devastating storm that's happened. And, you know, we're hearing that this kind of extreme weather will be happening more and more. You know, I, as I was driving down here, I saw the bare trees and a lot were on the roads, and it was quite perilous, actually. And I was just wondering what had happened to all the birds, you know, along with all the devastating consequences for local residents. So we have heard about collaborative working, but where do you see yourselves having a role to play in this when we talk about resilience, preparation and support, you know, across private third sector and private businesses, for example? I mean, what could that look like?
A good one for Graeme to kick off.
Thank you. I think it's a very pertinent question given the events of the weekend. There's really a couple of things in that. One is that, yes, absolutely, we will unfortunately see more of these high magnitude storm events, and therefore we need to be more resilient to that. So the sort of nature-based answer is that we need to build our ecosystems into more resilient places by doing that, by restoring these ecosystems so that they can withstand and be more resilient to those high magnitude events. But you're absolutely right that the human impact of that comes along too, and part of that is through adaptation planning. We're seeing a number of spatial adaptation plans coming through in Scotland now. Glasgow Clyde River Valley was the first adaptation plan. We're we're involved rather in starting to think of those in the Outer Hebrides. We're doing the same in Orkney. We're going to have to find a way that we can both be resilient to and mitigate those physical impacts of climate change, but also adapt to them. And I think one of the outcomes from COP26 is encouraging in that, you know, the understanding of the nature-based solutions, the fact that we have to do softer engineering, natural flood risk management, so peatland restoration in the uplands, more riparian planting, which slows down these big, fast, spating flood events. These all need to be implemented. I think the second challenge of that is actually how we fund it. It's not going to be deliverable just through the existing Nature Scotland budget. What we must do is move to a model of blended public-private finance to deliver nature-based solutions at scale. And we've got a few pilot projects in some landscapes where we're looking and we're talking to investors around quite significant elements of either peatland restoration or natural flood risk management. And I think that's a key role that Nature Scotland can play in the various different landscapes. And it does have to be driven by a risk assessment of what's actually going to be the impacts that we can predict on each individual particular area.
And I think David would want to come in with particularly the forestry aspect.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I mean it's a really important question because it goes to something that we're thinking about very carefully in forestry, which is a lot of the expansion and the drive towards more forestry is driven by climate change. But we absolutely need to remember that the climate is changing, and we need to think about what that means for Scotland's forests. So, yeah, we're still assessing the full impact of the storm. Obviously, the focus at the moment is on people and property, but it will have had an impact on forests in the northeast and in the borders and other places. And it's part of a broader conversation that we are leading and promoting within the forestry sector, which is we're designing and planting these new forests, but we need to make sure that they're as resilient as they can be. So what happens when it's drier than it has been in the past, or it's wetter than it has been in the past, or it's the climatic conditions are different. So we're leading on behalf of the UK a review of the UK forestry standard, and one of the aspects of that is building in a greater consideration of forest resilience and what can we do at the design stage and the planning stage to mitigate some of these risks.
Thank you. We will now move on to questions from Jim.
Thank you, Convener. Sorry, I thought other members of the panel were coming in there. I want to just touch on the farming community. This will probably be to all 4 years, actually. You will absolutely be aware of the tensions that there are between forestry and farming, because it's a constant that I get coming back to me, is that it's either forestry or farming as opposed to forestry and farming. So a lot of the questions that are put to me are the science behind carbon storage of forestry as opposed to naturally grazed land. The buying power of the forestry is pushing up the price of hill land beyond its current levels, which makes it absolutely unbuyable for somebody who wants to buy land to farm it. What work has been done to demonstrate by the forestry industry to really get to grips with that integration between farming and forestry so that the two things can work and cohabit? Is it true that Forestry Scotland are enabling greenwashing in Scotland? So we talk about private investors. Are they coming in and then we lose that natural capital in Scotland, or the value of that natural capital? And David, this is probably one just for you. Are you able to actually help farmers who want to plant things like orchards? I know that it's out with the scope of the current forestry plan, but is there a way of you being able to bring orchards in so that they're still growing trees, but they still get a crop out of it and potentially graze it as well? I know there's a lot in there, but this is a constant theme that comes back to me in the farming community in which I live. Can I start with yourself, David?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's a constant conversation for me too. I was in a meeting with the NFUS just yesterday talking about exactly this issue. I mean, I think what we always stress is that farming and forestry absolutely can work together. We are doing a lot of pretty well-received work with the farming community, with rural communities, about integrating trees on their land. And, you know, that the idea of shelter belts, riparian woodland. We have a growing demonstration network of farms that have converted perhaps some of their less productive land to forestry for benefits to livestock, benefits to flood management, benefits to the longer term financial prospects of the business. So the more than half the applications we receive for woodland creation through the forestry grant scheme offer less than 20 hectares, and they are predominantly smaller parts of existing farms and land-based enterprises. So we're doing a lot of I think we're doing quite well to integrate farming and forestry. The issue about larger holdings and larger estate transfers that then become that then come forward for reforestation. That is a constant theme. We're trying to quantify just how large how the scale of that issue. So the Scottish Land Commission are doing some research, which hopefully will report in the new year, about just the volume of those transactions, because there tend to be a few quite high profile totemic ones, but just want to get a handle on the scale of that transfer. Again, I go back to our statistics about what the forestry grant scheme is actually doing. 3/4 of the land that has been afforested in the lifetime of the scheme over the last 6-7 years is, according to the James Hutton classification, it's 5.2 or worse. So it's very much the rough grazing land, and it's the poorer quality upland grazing. One of the issues we're discussing with the NFUS is how can we offer farmers who are maybe when they get to the point where they sell they're thinking about selling the whole enterprise, can we offer them other options so that perhaps some of the land becomes afforested, but the better quality land remains in farming? So I think we're looking at how we can just, again, it's an extension of that integrating trees on farms work, is how can we give existing land managers and farmers more options for diversification, more opportunities to benefit from woodland creation themselves.
I think that before you come in there, we've got two witnesses that want to come in the back of that. Can I just pick up something, David? You talk about poor quality grazing and poor quality uplands. Is that in terms of agricultural production, or is it in terms of carbon sequestration or whatever? Because you quoted someone from the James Hutton Institute, and Rob Brooker, at one of the evidence sessions we had before, said that there's a need for more online systems to gather data to find out all these things to better help farmers. And I'm sure that will apply to foresters as well. So when you talk about low quality, is that just in terms of agricultural output? Or actually, do you consider going forward now, given the climate emergency, the best use of land in terms of carbon sequestration in the long term?
I think the answer to that is very complicated and very long. So the science about carbon sequestration on different kinds of land and different uses of that land is constantly changing and improving. I think my point was just the James Hutton classification is a broad classification of land across the whole of Scotland, and we can overlay that on our forestry grant scheme to get an idea of the kind of land. But obviously, on any particular scheme, these kind of broad classifications don't really answer the questions that you need to answer, and that's why we do take things on a case by case basis.
Thank you. I'm going to bring Grant in now to answer those questions, and then bring Jim back in.
Thanks. I mean, just a couple of things to add to that, and I think it's one of the things that needs to be looked at is the work around carbon, around things like grassland management, woodland management, peatland restoration, etc., is changing, and there's good stuff coming through, but there's always more we can learn around that. But the one thing I'd say about the woodland side of things is it is that integration between woodland and farming that we are not as good at in this country as I think we could be. And there are good examples. I mean, if you look at Europe, there's lots of places where farming and woodland are very much integrated, and places with much higher woodland cover than Scotland has. And I think one of the things we've got to look at is also is we can't look at trees just from a carbon point of view. So if we're looking at woodlands, it's got to be from, there's a carbon element to that, but there's also, we heard earlier about flood management, we heard earlier about some of the biodiversity benefits, but we also shouldn't be looking at trying to plant up whole areas in by land. So there's a balance between these things, and I think that some of the things we've got to look at is trying to get as good evidence out there as possible, and to work out not just say, I suppose, the right tree in the right place, but actually make that happen around how we do that. And hopefully there'll be some of the stuff that we're doing in the Cairn Gorms can help point towards that. But the other bit to that is, I think some of the changes in how we're doing rural payments in the future, we need to think about how we get that integration between agriculture and woodland more set out within those rural payments to make it easier for people to do that on their land.
Jim?
Yeah, Grant, I very much echo what I've just heard you saying there. It's got to be a far more integrated, and the farming community have to be taken along with this project, because there is undoubtedly real tensions at the moment. And I keep getting articles sent to me about grazed land will sequestrate as much carbon as forestry, trees will do more damage, and it takes you 25 years to get that back, etc., etc. But you're right, there's far more to it than just the carbon sequestration side of things. But in terms of what both of you have said, gives me some comfort that you're actually going to start looking at this in a much more holistic way, so that the farming community are part of this process, as opposed to it being forestry against farming. But David, I'm going to come back to you. I asked you the question about, are you able to allow farmers to plant things like orchards in their farms, which are far more open? And I know it isn't workable in the system that you have at the moment. Do you have the power to be able to integrate that type of planting on farms? If we talk about regenerative farming, one of the things that we're supposed to be doing is making sure we've got good woodland, but you can't just put it aside and it's done. If there's the opportunity to be able to graze in between it and get another crop off it, surely that's got to be beneficial for a regenerative farming system.
Yes, yeah, no, sorry, I forgot about the question about orchards in what I said previously. You're right. At the moment, it's almost the what you describe as the division between forestry and farming is it's manifested in the forestry grant scheme and the agricultural support schemes, and yes, orchards fall into the middle of that. Traditional foresters will tell you that orchards are not forests, and traditional farmers tell you that orchards are not farms. And I think that's so back to where we started, which is there are opportunities around the redesign and the kind of reinvigoration of agricultural subsidies and the work that's going on to do that. We are part of that that broader policy development and that conversation. So absolutely, we are looking for opportunities and ways that the kind of it's less dense than a forest, but it's still got trees on the farmland. Those particular kinds of agroforestry, looking how we can support that. So again, there's this integration, and it's not seen as a binary choice for landowners.
Okay, and one very last. Sorry, David, I'm giving you a grilling here. How do you answer the accusation that Scottish Forestry is allowing private investors to greenwash their business when they're not actually changing their businesses that they run?
I think Scottish Forestry is it's not facilitating the sale of land for afforestation. We are offering support for people that want to increase forest cover on the land. We do also have we are responsible for the Woodland Carbon Code, which is a scheme that allows people to generate and then benefit from accredited carbon credits. That's quite a regulated scheme. It has a whole set of conditions, and it has a whole set of regulatory activities associated with it. We are consistent with the Scottish Government's position, which is offsetting and the use of carbon credits should only be part of a clear plan and a clear journey towards net zero. So absolutely, the carbon credits can be used, but only as part of an overall decarbonisation plan.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, we are... We'll be looking at funding and whatever in next week's session, so that some of these topics will certainly come up again. Graham Neville would like to come in, and then Andy Wells.
Thanks, Convener. I was really just going to come back on the point of the agroforestry discussion point, and just to highlight the work that we've been doing in our natural capital pilot program, which is to test some of the solutions around, exactly as David was saying, how you get farms to have some more woodlands, hedgerow expansion, silvarable systems, silvopastoral systems, which allow, there's new native woodland expansion, but also sort of natural woodland creation. So we're part of the, as I think our Scottish Forestry, the national test programme to be launched next year, which will actually try and help farmers make those choices on a farm-by-farm basis, and with an understanding of the natural capital and the potential on their land, what they can then do to improve the biodiversity outcomes on single farm areas. So I think there's a lot of hope for progress in that area. It does involve gathering a lot better evidence, which we're trying to do at the moment, and sort of delivering that knowledge to farmers. And I think on the point around the carbon markets, I think this is something that's also been seen in peatland areas, but I think it's quite a fast-paced and quite a new emerging area. I think there is something in here around just ensuring that communities can continue to retain some of the benefits from that. I think that's quite an important point.
Can I just very quickly ask you, you mentioned hedgerows there. Sorry, Graham, can I just quickly ask you, mentioned hedgerows there. Are you including hedgerows now as well in your carbon audit of a farm and what the baseline of what a farm's carbon audit is?
That's included in what we're piloting outcomes-based approach. So this is a farm-based audit. So and I think hedgerows are included, but I can confirm that with the committee in follow-up.
Okay, thank you.
Detail of that.
Alan Wells, Andy Wells, when you come in, could you also cover, you're obviously Crown Estate, has forestry and estates, so you're a land manager. Can you pick up on some of Jim's points with that as well? But in your contribution, could you also touch on the foreshore? We've heard about blue carbon in a lot of our evidence sessions. In the last session we had, the expert on foreshores and blue carbon from wetlands and whatever didn't really think there was a role for Crown Estate. Can you comment on that, please?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Convener. On the forestry, just a couple of points to add to that discussion. It's a very live issue, and certainly, as has been pointed out, it's something that has come up very much in discussion with our tenant group particularly, and I was going to focus particularly on the tenanted sector in this respect. And we have tenants coming forward with looking at extensive planting schemes, who are looking at, to diversify their activities, but also, on the other hand, other tenants within the group that sort of, again, are concerned about the scale of change. We already have very highly integrated forestry and farming landscapes, particularly at Glenlivet, because of the history there. But there are, all these issues are certainly being played out. But as an organisation, Crown Estate Scotland is keen to work with our tenants to facilitate new planting at different scales. That could be small-scale hedgerows, but also potentially larger scales. But that has raised a number of issues, particularly in relation to the how that can be done within the agricultural tenancy and the sort of the legislative framework around that. We've been working with a number of other bodies, including STFA, Woodland Trust, Scottish Land Commission, our lawyers, and look at some of the barriers which are impacting on tenants wanting to plant trees. We've got some solutions, but there are difficulties associated with how that's treated within the agricultural lease, particularly if it's a large scale woodland. And we haven't got all the answers to that yet, but it's something that certainly we're working on and looking particularly at collaborating with the Scottish Land Commission on. One solution is potentially taking a the land out of the lease and coming up with a separate contract with the tenant to allow them to plant woodlands, which gets around some of the difficulties associated with how rent is calculated, how liabilities for managing the woodland and how carbon payments maybe are accommodated, and any way-going valuations, which is another issue within the lease, which creates issues. So there are a number of things there that are still sort of, you know, acting as a barrier to farmers who want to plant trees, but also that whole question around the consultation and the engagement with others in relation to the scale of woodlands in particular locations. On the foreshore element, I'm probably not the best person in the organisation to comment on that. I mean, I think I go back to our key role as an enabler and an investor, an asset manager. The investment side of things, you know, certainly, you know, we're making capital funds available for investment in land and property, which activities which might facilitate carbon sequestration on the foreshore. You know, the whole thing around seaweed, again, I'm not best to comment on that, but there are others in the organisation, and we can provide details about our approach to that element of carbon sequestration. We recognise, obviously, there's a lot of opportunity within the marine environment for sequestration. And, you know, again, other revenue funding that's going to support early stage projects or facilitation of research or whatever that Crown Estate Scotland's provided in this space. But I'm probably not the best person to answer that question, and would refer to other colleagues, and we can come back to committee on that point, that particular point.
Thank you. That would be very much appreciated. We're now going to move on to the theme of data collection and monitoring. Questions from Jenny.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel. 2 weeks ago, we took evidence from some scientists about the climate and nature emergency, and they raised a number of points in relation to gaps in data collection and suggested that perhaps land managers, farmers, crofters and fishers could provide this information. And so I'd be interested to know what your bodies do with regards to, I suppose, local wisdom and evidence captured by people within the communities. And also, kind of moving on from a point that you made, Graham, about the blended public and private funding, two of the scientists, Dr. Tara Marshall, for example, talked about when industries are decommissioning or changing things, they capture a lot of data which perhaps could be used more widely. And I just wonder if you have any thoughts on whether there is actually a need for this data to be accessed more widely to ensure that we all move forward with regards to the climate emergency and nature emergency. So kind of two sides to the question, one about local gathering of data, but also what happens by corporations. So Grant, will I start with you?
Thanks for that. Data is going to be ever more crucial as we go forward over the next 10 years, and it's certainly something that we're looking to try and make sure we've got the right baseline, if you like, to then be measuring things from where we are. So I think I mentioned earlier we've just done the baseline on the carbon audit for the whole national park, which will give us some really good where we are at the moment on that side. But the one that's it's on a slightly longer timescale, but we're kicking on with is the Cairngorms Nature Index, which I think could be really interesting. It's based on the Norwegian Nature Index. We've been working closely with people in Norway, and it's in effect to give you an ecosystem health index for the national park. So things like looking at river systems or looking at woodland systems and saying, well, how healthy are these systems within the park? What is it that we can then do to try and then increase their health? And that means, doing all the work that we need to do on the climate and the nature crisis side of things. And then the other bit to that is that we have a lot of citizen science in the park, and there's a lot of encouragement of citizen science in the Cairngorms Nature partnership, and making sure that we get a lot of the data, because a lot of the data that is collected on the park is done by volunteers. A huge amount of that is done by volunteers, and it's then entered into all the different data management things at a national level, whether that be the National Biodiversity Network or things like the Northeast Biological Recording side of things. And then we know also that there's information that's collected by land managers, et cetera, and we use that in good conversations with them around some of the work we do on moorland and things like that within the national park as well. So I think data is absolutely absolutely crucial to that. I'm probably less well placed to talk about the corporation side of things, and I'll probably leave that to somebody else. But all I would say is that we're becoming more and more data rich, as in we know more and more and more, but we also need to do more with that data to look at it and actually understand it. And I think that's probably where we need to spend more of our time and to work collectively across the public sector, because I suspect none of us are big enough to do it individually. And actually how we all work together collectively to look at that data and then to work out what it's telling us to then actually make the right decisions is one of the key things that we need to do as a partnership of public bodies and wider into the NGOs and other sides of things.
Thanks, Grant. Interestingly, you mentioned Norway. I would automatically ask as well, what are you learning from the national parks in America as well? Because I think you met with them at COP26.
Yeah, I mean, it was actually a really interesting discussion with the American National Parks around. They were really interested in the carbon audit work we're doing. So we're following that up to have a conversation around the carbon side of things, because whilst, you know, national parks are different in different parts of the world, it's incredible how many are the similar issues that we're facing, whether that be, you know, extreme weather conditions, drought, or whether that be lack of snow, and used to be so. So we're doing some follow-up work with the American National Parks, and we'll hope that that will bear fruit. But I should say that carbon audit work that we're doing in the Cairngorms is also part of carbon audit work we're doing with all 15 UK national parks. So all the national parks in UK are following that forward. So Lake District have already done it. We've just got ours. Loch Lomond, I think, will be getting their one done early next year. So slowly but surely, all the national parks. So we ought to look across the national park family in the UK as well.
Great. Thank you. David, do you want to? Could you answer my initial questions?
Yes, absolutely. I think I would say that the use of data and data in forestry has great potential. We have a certain amount of what you might call aggregate data about the volume, the areas, the volume of timber that's harvested. But there's a lot of untapped information, and I was interested in the background paper about how that can be used. I think from a local perspective, again, when a new afforestation scheme comes through, then there will quite often be habitat surveys, breeding bird surveys, ecological surveys, archaeological surveys. Now they tend to exist in terms of kind of hard copy reports or electronic copy reports, but I feel there's a lot of data in there, so there's potential to exploit that a bit more. On the citizen science that Grant has just mentioned, tree health and pests and diseases are one of our kind of key risks. We have our own surveillance program, but we also have a publicly available system called Tree Alert. So if people see something that they think is a pest or a disease or some kind of damage to trees, they can use that, and then we can follow it up. At the very opposite end of the scale to the local data, we have satellite information. One of the things we're doing this week is we have we're using satellite data to detect felling on a kind of 6-monthly basis, because you can see the height differential when the satellite goes over. We're just exploring what we can do this week and next week to see if we can use that to quantify the damage, because that's obviously a lot quicker, and it's, to be honest, a lot safer than sending people out into the forests right now. So yeah, again, there's a lot of potential, and it's finding the best projects to take forward.
Great, thank you, David. Graham, if you could comment, if you can, about accessing data from other organisations and businesses.
Yes, thank you. It's an important question. I think in NatureScot we have usually, with the exception of sort of rare or vulnerable species, we've made our data available through a variety of sources, and one of the key ones is the Scottish Environment Web. Which is a publicly available land and data source. We've got data sharing agreements with obviously Scottish Government for their rural payments and services system and farm data systems. We've got other data sharing agreements. So I think we're coming at it from a position of you're being able to and being quite proactive in sharing our data. I think the point is an important one, though, around that sort of the decommissioning or the data that's collected during the course of a project. And I think we would agree that the default position should be that the data should be made available. We could do that through a condition on any project that or license that is approved. But there is a lot of data collected by private or academic sources that is not in the public domain. So I think, yes, there probably is some work to be done to try to improve that data knowledge. But, you know, equally, as colleagues have said, we are quite data rich as it is, and we are quite good at collecting that local level data as well as the higher scale. Even through citizen science, as David had just mentioned, you know, there's a huge amount of data collected by volunteers. Smartphone apps are brilliant these days for, you know, you go out on a walk with the kids and the dog and you see something and you can record it spatially, you know, immediately. And that's actually a very powerful tool for gathering that. But we mustn't also forget that, you know, the sectors, the businesses, the people that are working in the rural environment do have a considerable amount of that local knowledge. Is it necessarily in our data set? How do we access it? I think that's a question as well that we need to address in a bit more depth.
Yeah, that was really helpful, Graeme, and I think certainly I recognise that in my own community. There's someone that we know that feeds in information about dead dolphins or porpoises on our beaches, but it's knowing the person to go to, so it's how you get that information captured. Andy, have you got anything to add from the Crown Estate's perspective?
Yes, indeed. Obviously, data is absolutely key to our asset management function, and having the details of what we manage, the agreements, but also all the other data that we can gather that can help inform decision making is quite key to us. We currently make data on our assets available on the Crown Estate Scotland website. On a spatial basis, it can be downloaded. We contribute data on a regular basis to SEPA's aquaculture portal. We've been supporting the Dynamic Coast Project, which we heard about earlier this morning, to provide strategic evidence base on the coastal erosion, again, in relation to spatial data. And we've almost completed work on an open data portal on our assets, which can use technology to make sharing data much more streamlined. So that's something that we're about to sort of launch. And we make we benefit from free access to data from SNH and Marine Scotland. At a local level, again, an example of where we've worked within the community, Glenlivet particularly, we partnered with the park again and other organisations in the Glenlivet Landscape Partnership. And through that, there was a data gathering exercise and a lot of local information held on wildlife data, et cetera. And, you know, we've run a project there for many years, working with the local community to gather biodiversity data through a local wildlife recording group. So it's something that, again, we're very keen to continue to work on and develop.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And finally, we're going to move on to questions from Ariane on the National Planning Framework 4.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, so I'm very keen on the National Planning Framework 4, and I imagine that all of you have engaged with it, being that you're public bodies. It's a crucial tool for achieving net zero in Scotland and making sure we've got flourishing biodiversity. We've heard about the land use pressures from your responses to Jim, and some of you have mentioned master plans, land use plans, and spatial mapping. And given that the amount of land we have in Scotland is finite, there are great demands on it for housing, forestry, agriculture, carbon sequestration, renewables, infrastructure, and more. And it seems that there's probably a need for an overarching land use plan for the whole of Scotland, which would enable us to use the land we have most efficiently and equitably. So I'm wondering if there's any work like that taking place, and if not, do you think it would be a useful approach? And if so, how much more data and research would be required to develop something like this? Kind of coming back to the joined up approach that we talked about at the beginning. So if anyone wanted to pick that up, I'd appreciate it.
What I would quite like to do, if you could all, we'll give you all the opportunity, but if you could keep your comments as brief as possible. That would be really useful. If we start with Grant.
Just very briefly, I'd say that's what a national partnership plan is for the Cairngorms. It tries to set out what the priorities are across a range of things to do with land, communities, transport, etc. It's also, we're developing the regional land use framework as well within the park, and obviously there's other people doing pilots on those at the moment as well. So I'd say I'd point at that document and the draft that's out at the moment to have a look at that in terms of that integration of all those things. And obviously it links very closely into the National Planning Framework because it's also the regional spatial strategy for the national park as well. So I think there's actually some really good examples in the national parks of how spatial planning can be done, and then how we can do that, how we can do that on the ground. But I'll leave it at that because time is tight.
Thank you. And Graham.
Thank you. I think there's a number of areas that we very much welcome in the NPF and around the ambition and intent around that integration. I think we would actually welcome a little bit more of a directive approach in the NPF4 to ensure that the regional land use pilots and spatial and other regional spatial strategies are kind of more integrated, and we can get a bit more direction for developers where it's appropriate to develop, and where nature restoration would be the opportunity to be best targeted. I think there's a number of landscape partnership pilots underway, as I mentioned earlier, that kind of bring all that in a more granular spatial way suitable to that landscape. And I think that's where we would see the most return on investment to actually develop those and the vision for those areas that are quite a detailed way.
Thank you. And Andy?
I'll try and be brief. In fact, I'm happy to be brief on this subject. It's not something that I know a great deal about in relation to our work. But we've mentioned Glenlivet Master Planning. That's key at a local level, and we hope that will be very much a test for the regional land use partnership approach. Placemaking is key to Crown Estate Scotland's approach in terms of built development. We're working with around Scotland with a number of local authorities, Angus Council in development of the Montrose area that acquired. We've got arrangements with North Ayrshire Council looking at placemaking investment in that area. And of course, there's the National Marine Plan, of which we're a key player in relation to the whole offshore energy infrastructure development. So it's certainly something that our policy team are very closely involved in.
Thank you very much. And finally, David.
Thank you. I'll be brief. Welcome NPF4. I think it helpfully sets out the protections and strengthens the protections on woodlands. The climate change targets are clear. We have to increase woodland creation. We have to have more woodlands. Two questions that therefore flow from that. What kind of woodlands we have? How do we balance timber, biodiversity, carbon? And the second question is, where do they go? Which we're about in the landscape, and that has to be a broader conversation than Scottish Forestry can have. It has to be through the parks, through the regional land use partnerships, and through the local communities.
Thank you very much, and that brings this session to end. Can I just thank you all for taking part today and providing us with some most valuable information. We look forward to catching up with you again over the session. So thank you. Now move on to agenda item 2, UK subordinate legislation. Today we're considering two notifications from the Scottish Minister for consent to the following instruments: the Sea Fisheries Amendments, etc., number 2, Regulations 2021, and the Wine Amendment Regulations 2021. And I refer members to paper 3 and 4 and page 17 onwards in our paper pack. Under the protocol between the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government, these consent notifications have been categorised as Type 1, meaning the Scottish Parliament's agreement is sought before the Scottish Government gives consent to the UK Government making secondary legislation in devolved competence. Considering the two notifications separately, in relation to the Sea Fisheries SI notification, do any members have any comments on the consent notification? Mercedes.
I had a couple of questions about it. I don't know if it's something we can write to the minister about or how it works. Just that it said about the proposal increases the amount of sea bass that can be landed as bycatch. And I was just looking for a bit of clarification about why that would be expanded. And then also about revoking a closed season for fishing sand eels. I was had some questions about that. But.
Absolutely. If I refer you to paragraphs 7 and 10 on page... I wrote it down. Page 22. There's some questions there that I was going to write to the government seeking some clarification, and I'll ensure those topics are included in that letter for further information. Is the committee content that the provisions set out in the notification should be included in the proposed UKSI, and that I write to the Scottish Government for clarification on some information on paragraphs 7 to 10? Okay, thank you. In relation to the wine SI notification, I wrote to the Cabinet Secretary asking for an amended notification, as I felt the level of information included was not sufficient to inform the committee's consideration. A response was received yesterday and members were sent a supplementary paper. I am now content the information provided by the Scottish Government is sufficient to inform parliamentary scrutiny. Does any member have any comments on the consent notification for the wine SI? Is the committee content that the provisions set out in the notification should be included in the proposed UKSI? Thank you. I just want to put on record that in the letter I received from the Cabinet Secretary, we understand that the Cabinet Secretary has apologised that the full 28 days for parliamentary scrutiny has not been provided, and that the reason was confusion at official level about whether this SI met the criteria for a Type 2 notification. It's my intention to write to the Scottish Government to ask for some level of a guarantee that this sort of confusion won't happen again, and that the committee won't be left with little time to properly scrutinise any of these instruments that come forward in the future. Finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off a letter to the Scottish Government informing it of our decisions today? Thank you very much. And that concludes our business for today. At next week's meeting, we will take evidence as part of our climate and emergency, nature emergencies session, and consider subordinate to legislation. Thank you all. I now close this meeting.